Good morning to Dr. Dalvi, my dear colleagues, and all dear participants. We are now today on the last day of our 6 days journey. We have explored many areas of research, and today we are going to explore one very important area of research. We have seen research question, we have seen objectives, we have seen hypothesis, we have seen yesterday tool, reliability, establishing reliability, validity, drafting a proposal, many areas. But yes, this area is very, very, very important towards the end, which conveys to us what we have concluded as far as our research is concerned. And that is our analysis. And today we are going to explore descriptive and inferential analysis. And we have a very renowned, Dr. Dalvi calls himself a statistician. So we have a renowned mathematician with us who will be helping us to explore this area. So it is my proud privilege to introduce Dr. Dalvi to you all. So we have Dr. Madhukar Dalvi with us, who has got PhD, MPhil, and MSc in mathematics to his credit. Dr. Dalvi has also done postgraduate diploma in operations research for management. At present, Dr. Dalvi is working as an assistant professor with Nagindas Khanwala College, Malad. Dr. Dalvi has got almost 26 years of experience, and mainly teaching in the subjects in which he has got specialization, like mathematics, statistics, and operational research. Sir has got technical skills also in educational technology and SPSS package. Sir is on various editorial boards as member and as an advisor also for various publication houses. Sir is a member of a peer-reviewed committee for the subject of mathematics, statistics, and computer science for multidisciplinary journal also. Sir is a university nominee as a member of BOS, Department of Mathematics and Statistics, KES College, Kandivali. Sir has provided research consultancy to 73 PhD scholars, 7 MPhil scholars for data analysis, research data analysis. And 2 scholars are right now, their work is in progress. Sir has been invited in almost 54 research workshops, refresher courses, as a resource person on topics related to research data analysis. I'm sure we would not have got a better person than Dr. Dalvi for exploring the area of descriptive and inferential analysis. I can speak volumes about Sir's credentials and achievements, but Professor Dr. Dalvi has yesterday requested, ma'am, please keep it very brief and crisp. So as per Dr. Dalvi's suggestions, I'm keeping it very brief. Professor Dalvi, it is our proud privilege to have you with us today for this session. So I take this privilege and opportunity on behalf of Gujarat Research Society's Hansa Jeevandas College of Education, our principal ma'am, Dr. Anita Swami, entire JCE faculty, and our dear participants. I extend a very, very, very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Before I request Dr. Dalvi to begin with the session, Dr. Dalvi has yesterday requested that he would like to make this session very interactive one. So dear participants, the way you are putting up your questions in the chat box, in between also, Dr. Dalvi would like to take up your questions and make the session interactive. So keep on posting your questions as and when you feel like asking any question to sir. Now, sir, I request you to begin with your session. Over to you, Dr. Dalvi. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Karuna Sinha, coordinator for this particular program.
Thank you, sir.
To begin with, I would like to.
Sir, before we begin, as you have said, coordinator, we have two more coordinators also, our team. Dr. Usha Borkar and Dr. Archana Katkeri is also there from the college, sir.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
To begin with, I would like to thank the management of college, AJ College of Education. Dr. Anita Swami, principal of AJ College of Education. Dr. Usha and Dr. Archana, two more coordinators, along with Dr. Karuna Sinha, for giving me opportunity for this particular program of capacity building and pre-PhD workshop. Actually, it's a type of program. Must be a 5 days program, and today is the last day of this particular program. Before I start, let me just tell you a few things. And then I've actually joined from two instruments, so my camera is not working properly. So after some time, you may not be able to see me directly, but I'll be audible completely throughout the session. So in this particular session of 2.5 hours, right, I'll be actually taking you through the data analysis process, both descriptive as well as the inferential analysis. And the more focus will be on inferential analysis, because people always have difficulties in inferential analysis, that is hypothesis testing. And while doing that, I'll be taking you through a software, an online software, which is freely available. The name of the software is Jamori, simultaneously. I know that I've seen a message. There is a technical difficulty in downloading. This may happen because of your system requirements. So those who are having a technical difficulty in downloading, please check your system requirements, and accordingly, you can download a certain version of that particular software. It is not difficult to download, it is simple. While explaining this, I'll be taking you through the process of download also. So that time also, you may just see and go through. But I don't want to take time on downloading, that everybody will download and all. But you can definitely experiment the things later on. One more thing, during the whole 2.5 hour session, I don't expect anybody to write the things on the PPT. You may write the other things, because I'll be sharing my PPT along with other files which are relevant. And later on, you may go through those files and you may use those files for study purpose. Okay, so you need not bother about writing anything on this from the slide, because there are so many slides. I generally share my slides. And not only that, while explaining, it is very difficult. It will be very difficult for all of you to keep a track of writing. Some extra material also on the slides I share. So those things will be helpful to you in your future whenever you want to do data analysis on your own. And as madam already told you, that you need to post your questions whenever you feel. I'll be checking the chat box, right? So it is better to have questions there and then only on the chat box, so that you will not have any difficulty later on. Of course, at the end also, if possible, I'll keep few minutes for question answer session, if possible. I don't know. I want to finish the things first. Possible, I'll try to keep some time for question answers. But I think by that time, all of you will be able to definitely understand the answers to most of the questions. If any question missed, ask me again that time. Okay. And if required at all, you may unmute yourself. That the organizers may help me to unmute those people and ask questions also. I don't mind those things also. Only thing is, if everybody is asking, then there is a chance that something will you know, go wrong in a different way. So I don't want to do that. So chatbox is always better way. But there are certain things which you cannot ask in the chatbox. You may ask open. That's absolutely perfect. Now, kindly give me 1 minute to start actual session. I'll be starting with the other questions. Hello, am I audible, madam? Am
yes,
I audible?
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are very much audible, sir.
And my screen is visible?
Yes, sir. Screen is also visible, sir.
Okay. Thank you once again. Today we are going to begin. Let me just tell you how I've divided this particular session of 2.5 hours. First of all, we'll be beginning with the basics, very basic things about the research. I generally start with the research because analysis is the later stage of research. So all of you should know the basic things that we are going to recall exactly. So the first part, and then we will go ahead with the very important part of the research that is called as scales. So we'll discuss primary scales, nominal, ordinal, and the respective statistics which is possible for those scales. While doing this, I'll be taking you to a particular case study also. Not complete case study, but a part of case study where I'll explain questionnaire in short. Right, because without questionnaire, data analysis is not possible. So in short, I'll be explaining. I'll be talking to you regarding the reliability, validity also, because that is related to the questionnaire tool. So that part also I'll be doing simultaneously, but not spending much time. I'll just show you slides related to that and a content part of it. But definitely, I will be taking you to the software then immediately, where I will show you how to calculate the reliability value. And even the consistency part also, I will try to explain in this particular part. So our focus will be, you know, analysis. So we should know how to calculate and how to analyze. Then in the later part, we will go to descriptive analysis, where we will study the basics of descriptive analysis. And again, through Jamovi, a software called as Jamovi, I'll show you how to calculate and interpret the results related to the descriptive analysis. Then the third part of the particular presentation will be the inferential analysis. In the inferential analysis, we will be talking about different the process of hypothesis, few basics of hypothesis test, and then one by one we will go for parametric as well as non-parametric test. Most of the focus will be on parametric test because those tests are generally used. Obviously, non-parametric tests will come simultaneously. So this is a plan of this particular 2.5 hour session. Okay, so let us begin initially to talk about two questions. Let me just. Give me a minute, please.
Sure, sir. Sure, sir. No worries.
Okay, so let us begin with two questions. I generally start with these two questions whenever I actually start my workshop. So now I just want you people to reply on these two questions. What is your idea of research? That is, what is research and how to do research? The first question is, what is research? So quickly, please try to answer this question. I know that all of you are researchers, either teachers or researchers. So I expect some answers from you. Please do it quickly. What is research according to you? First question, what is research? Please put answers in the chat box. Solution to a problem. Search for answers. Research question, okay. To study something new, systematic search for answers to problem, okay, finding out the solutions to the problem, very good. Investigation, find out solutions to the problem, okay. So most of you feel that it is a solution, systematic investigation, it's a good thing. Systematic way, scientific process, okay, fine, finding out answers. Okay, discover something new, fine, empirical study, yes, thank you very much, right? So, you know, that actually shows that, you know, research, when we go for research, actually, you know, there are, everybody thinks in a different way, there are different definitions, right? But more or less, the idea altogether will give you what is research. And how do we do research? Now, second question. Please try to answer second question. How do we do research? What is the procedure of research? I'm expecting the process. You may just write in a short, right? What you do? What is the first step of a research? Anybody? The first step of a research? Proposal. Identifying topic, question to a problem. But how do we identify a problem? Whether it will come directly? My question is, what is the first step of the research? First thing what you will do? First thing. Yes, somebody came out with the answer. It is actually The first thing is you start with review, reading. You have to read a review of literature. Then gap analysis, very good. Then identify a problem at a simultaneously. What is the problem? Of course, one has to think about the problem and then they go for a review. But then exact problem framing will be possible after the review. Yes. So you have to review first, then frame your problem, then objective along with hypothesis, and then other research, how to collect the data and questionnaire, etc., etc. And finally, you will reach for the analysis and interpretation and conclusions. So this is a general process for research. Okay. So very good. Thank you very much for responding quickly. Yeah. So now let us proceed further. And I have a simple definition with me. For me, research is an organized, systematic way of finding answers to the questions. Right? I think most of you have given this indirectly, this particular definition. It's an organized way, systematic way, finding answer to the questions, right? Which finding answer to the question, most of you have given this thing in your definitions or in your meaning of research. Okay, so this is how actually I look at it. It's an organized way. One has to organize it very systematic way. Otherwise, you know, if you are not systematic and organized, it will take a lot of time for your research. So you have to be very organized. And finally, we are to finding answers to the questions. And these questions, I mean, research questions, which we'll actually get from your review of literature related to your topic after the gap analysis. So this is actually a general process of research where you have to frame a research title. Obviously, while doing this, review of literature play a very important role. Then after the gap analysis of literature review, you'll have to find out the problems or questions related to your research. In fact, the gap analysis itself will give you research questions. Based on research questions and problems, you will have objectives, you'll have different objectives and hypothesis. Then for objectives and hypothesis, you need to collect data. Remember that. Now this terminology, remember, objectives we are going to verify and hypothesis we are going to test. So objective verification and hypothesis testing, right? That is again a very important thing that you have to remember. And for this objective verification and hypothesis testing, you need a data, and data can be primary as well as secondary. Remember that your study may be having only primary data, only secondary data, or a combination of primary and secondary data will do, right? What actually ideally people sometimes do, if they want to go for a combination, they may have objective, particular objective. For that, secondary data is useful. Second objective, primary data. Third objective, again, primary data. Fourth objective, secondary data. Like that, so it can be a combination study also. Even hypothesis can be tested on the secondary data, right? But please remember that when I'm talking about this type of data, I'm talking about the numeric data. I'm not talking about the categorical data. So the whole particular 2.5 hour session will be on numeric data, right? Numeric data. So it is not actually qualitative data analysis. So we will be talking, I'll be actually going for quantitative data analysis. Quantitative means numeric data, numbers. Of course, there we will have a categorical variable at a certain place where the variables are converted into numbers. But there are categories, there are qualitative data which cannot be converted. We require coding, right? That different procedure we need to apply. So I'll not be talking about that. So I'll be focusing on this. And once we are having the data, primary, secondary, quantitative data, then that data can be useful for analysis. Generally, we actually divide analysis into part descriptive and inferential analysis. Descriptive analysis is actually where we describe, where actually we are going to use some descriptive parameters, like initially we prepare tables, then graphs, frequency tables, percentage, etc. And then we use some statistical descriptive tools also, mean, median, mode, standard deviation, quartile deviation, skewness, kurtosis, as well as correlation and regression tools also, basic tools. This actually, descriptive analysis generally be used for objective verification. Remember this. So the first section is related to the objective verification, whereas the second one, that is inferential analysis, is focused on only hypothesis testing, where we will learn hypothesis. So today we are going to go for both of this. Okay, so what we generally do, we are having, how do we organize our data? We actually have our research title and research objectives and hypothesis. Related to research objective, either we collect a primary data and secondary data. Remember that there can be a qualitative data also, but here we are not going to discuss qualitative. We are going to focus only on quantitative data analysis. Okay. Now this data, primary data, can be collected to survey, observations, focus group, etc. For that, we need to understand the concept of population and sample. Population is actually all units of our study, and sample is a part of a population. We may go for a secondary data. For that, source of a data is very, very important, right? So we can have a web sources, groups, journals, etc. Right? So which we have to maintain every time. And in the research, right, to avoid a plagiarism, right, we need to have a complete record of the sources and the proper sources, and even the timing of dates and timing of this resourcing websites and all has to be kept in the record so that you can mention in the study. So basically, we need to focus on the this thing. So today, we'll be focusing on primary data, but secondary data is the data which is a numeric data which one can analyze simultaneously. For primary data analysis, or for actually specifically for a survey, we prepare a questionnaire, right? And while preparing a questionnaire, we need to understand primary skills, right? So which we'll be discussing now immediately after this slide. Primary skills, what are primary skills? You must have heard about nominal, ordinal, right? All those scales, interval scale, and the ratio scale. All four scales we'll be discussing in the initial stage. And then why do we need to do this? And general questions. What are general questions? Demographic questions, right? So we need to divide our section, our questionnaire, in two sections. First of all, general questions, demographic related questions. And remember that demographic questions have to be very relevant. You should not keep on asking so many demographic questions, right? So, and then for objectives, we required a question scale, particular scale, nominal, ordinal, or interval. But for hypothesis, the scale is interval and ratio. I'll explain this part because this is something very important when we go for analysis generally. If your data collection is using the observation, so we need to prepare an observation sheet, right? General observation sheet and some fixed time we have to decide and record all these observations also. So very few people go for observation study. So let us focus on questionnaire, because most of the time we go for a questionnaire when we go for a primary data analysis. Before we actually proceed to the scale, let us try to understand the difference between measurement and scaling. Now when we go for measurement and scaling, right, the basic difference is what? Measurement is assigning a number or a symbol to a characteristics. And scaling is organizing them in an increasing or decreasing order. Let me just give an example for this, very simple example. Most of you are teachers, right? I suppose most of this particular group is teachers group. So we evaluate the examination papers, right? And when we evaluate different questions and their answers. And we give marks to the students depending upon the type of answer they have given. So when this answer is evaluated, what we do is we actually measure indirectly. We go through the answer and then we, in our mind, or we have a complete solution with us. So we measure that and then give some marks. So when we measure that and give some marks, that is called as measurement. That is called as measurement. And then what we do, we are having say 100 students. We have evaluated the answer papers of 100 students. We have marks of each and every student. We organize these marks in increasing order or a decreasing order. That is called as creating a continuum through the data or the objects. This is called as scaling. Okay. Another example, suppose today I am delivering a session for you. At the end of the session, if I ask you, rate my sessions on this 10-point scale, that is 1 to 10. 1 is minimum, that is very bad, and maybe 10 is very good or best presentation. So then you will give some ratings to my particular presentation. So that rating when you give, you will go through 2 hour, 2.5 hour session, and then you will understand how I have delivered, what was my content, everything. And then you give certain marks, right? So that is called as measurement. And you assign you some number, say 5, 6, 7, 8, 2, 1, whatever it is, whatever you're feeling. So that is called as measurement. Whereas if there are 100 participants in this particular program, so all those scores are organized in increasing order, that is called as scaling. I hope this part is clear to all of you, measurement and scaling, the difference between measurement and scaling. If it is clear, please type yes, understood. You can just type Y in the chat box. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So the difference between measurement and scaling. Thank you. Thank you very much. Clear to all of you. Now let us proceed further to the actual different primary scales. Now we are going for scales now. What are different primary scales? So now this is an example of scaling. Now I'm going to talk about nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. Right? I know that most of you must have gone through this particular one. I don't know whether this earlier 4 days anybody has already discussed on this particular aspect of nominal, ordinal, interval or not. Right? But let me start with this thing. Right? See, what is the difference and why these scales are very important? Remember that whenever we talk about a data has a scale. Right, particular question and a data has a scale. So that one has to understand. And according to the scale, we are going to decide our analysis process. Right? The big question people are having, which statistical tools we should use for analysis? Say you have a data, you have a question, and question will give you data. You have conducted a survey and you have a data. So now the big question arises, whether I calculate mean, median, mode, whether standard deviation is possible or not, whether mean is suitable or not, right? All these questions are there, whether graph is possible, I can prepare which type of diagram, right? All these questions are there. So for that, we have to understand this particular scale called as nominal, primary scales, nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. Okay, so let me make it very simple for this and proceed further for this particular scales. The first scale is called as nominal scale. Okay, so here is one example, right? I don't know if anybody has attended my previous workshops. So I generally start with this few slides generally, which is common, and then I keep on changing. This nominal scale is actually scale for a question which is categorical type. Now, let me just give an example of a question which is categorical type. Okay, now what do you mean by categorical? The answer is categories. For example, in your questionnaire, in a general section, there is a question based on gender. Gender. Now, gender has, say, 3 options. Male, female, and transgender. Okay, so if somebody wants to answer this question, gender, so the answer of this question would be male, female, or transgender, right? It cannot be a number, right? So the answer to the question or a variable, gender is a variable, answer to the variable is a category, right? It is a categorical variable. It is not a number. So such variables are called as categorical variables. Another example. Educational qualification. Now, when we talk about educational qualification, Right? Your educational qualification will be undergraduates. Let us start with undergraduates. You may have below that also. Graduates, postgraduates, PhDs, etc. etc. So again, the variable is categorical variable. The reason is the answers to the questions are categories. Correct? Whereas, if I ask you a question, what is your age? What is your age? Then answer this question would be 25, 32, 52, like this, some number, right? So this age variable is a numeric variable. Age is a numeric variable. Similarly, salary, right? Salary, there is a fixed number. So when I say salary, there is a fixed number. Somebody will answer, right? I earn a salary of 50,000 rupees, 72,000 rupees, whatever it is. So that salary, right? Salary is a numeric variable. Understood? So now just keep this in mind. The variable is called numeric, where the answer to the variable is number, it's called as numeric. And the variable is categorical if the answer is categorical. So that we have to remember. But sometimes we can make variable as a categorical variable. Numeric variable can be converted into categorical variable. Let me give an example. Age. Instead of saying, I say age group, and then I mention some groups. Age group below 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, 40 to 50. So when I'm making age group, right, remember, now the answer is what? One of the group we are going to select, that is called as category. So age group is a categorical variable, whereas age is a numeric variable. I think the difference between numeric and categorical variable is clear to all of you. Please keep on typing yes for Y for yes. And if you have not understood, please type no.
Good morning, sir. But teaching experience would be categorical or numerical? Numerical, sir.
No, it can be teaching experience. It can be, it depends upon the type of question you are asking. If you are giving 5 to 2 groups for that, say 5 to 7 years, right? Then it is a categorical variable. If you ask open-ended question, that is, what is your teaching experience? How many years? 5 years, 6 years, 5.5 years, 5 years and 6 months, like that, then it becomes a numeric variable. Okay, it depends upon the question. We are going to have some exercise at the end of this particular thing. Just wait for a few minutes, okay? More or less, your ideas will be clear about categorical variables and this thing. Okay, so let me just proceed further. So now, why I'm explaining this particular variable? Nominal and ordinal, this particular two scales are related to the categorical variables. And interval and ratio generally relate to the numeric variables where the answers are numbers. You will see here, I have written numbers here, and here I have written categories. But in the first case also, I have written some numbers. Let me explain this. This is actually a data related to an athletic competition held at a particular moment, right? So there are 3 winners. What are the 7, 8, and 3 represents? These are the numbers on the back side of the runners. Generally, when they attend the competition, we give them numbers to identify. Rather than, you know, name, it is good to have number on the back side. It is very easy to identify. So the numbers are given to this particular one. So these numbers does not have any particular meaning. What does it mean? That this 8 is not greater than 3 or 3 is not less than 8 in this case. It is just an identification number, right? Nothing greater or nothing less. Somebody may take number 10, somebody may take 99. It's everybody's wish, or we may decide some number, 3-digit, 4-digit number, but they have no specific meaning for those numbers. They are just identification. For example, for gender, right? For male, I may give number 1, for female, I will give 2, and for transgender, I'll give 3. But this does not mean that 3 is greater than 2 or 3 is greater than 1 or like that, right? It's just an identification number. Similarly, for educational qualification also, I can give some numbers, right? So they are not they are just numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. They are called as code in our language. So the first scale is generally used for a categorical variable where the answers are given in the form of category. Okay, say for example, gender, male, female, and transgender. Three options are there. So somebody has to select that. Okay, so that is a typical example of a nominal scale. Now here I can change the order. That is, I can start with transgender, or I can start with female, then male, and then transgender, or I can say transgender, female, and male. So where order is not that important, when order is not important, and the answers are categories, or a variable is categorical variable, the scale of that variable or a question is called as a nominal scale. Just keep in mind. So what two things you will remember? The first thing is answers are categories. Number two, this category can be reorganized. They have no orders. Such scale of a question is called as nominal scale. Whereas ordinal scale. Now, ordinal scale is again for the categories, but there is an order. The word ordinal, right? So there is an order here. So order is very important. Let me give an example of an educational qualification. When we write educational qualification, suppose options are undergraduates, graduates, postgraduates, and then the PhD, MPhils and all, then what will happen? We are forced to write first undergraduate, then graduate, and then postgraduate. I cannot start with postgraduate, then undergraduate, then graduate, and I am not allowed to mix it up. I have some order. I have to maintain some order, and that is important in this particular scale, right? So nominal and ordinal scale, the only difference is in the second part, we are having an order. Third scale is generally used for rating, right? Whenever I give an example, a rating scale on 0 to 10, right? So that is a rating scale. So here, performance is measured on the rating scale. The first person, the person who is first, right, got 9.6 marks on the rating scale. The second one is getting 9.1, and third one is getting, this is 10-point rating scale. Or under this category, there are certain scales like agreement scale, Likert scale, right? So 5-point, 7-point agreement scale. Then other scales also, satisfaction, Likert like scale. All those scales may appear also. So those things.
Sir, may I come in here, sir? Sorry.
Yes.
Sir, if you are making a questionnaire with always, sometimes, and never, it will be interval, right? Yeah. Even if there are no numbers, we are just putting always, sometime, never. Yeah. And the participants have to rate themselves. It would be intervals. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Then the last scale is a ratio scale. In the ratio scale, we give direct answer. This last scale is generally used for completely numeric data. For example, age, salary, direct salary I'm talking about, right? Age, salary, all such variables where the numbers are your answers. For example, in this case, this particular, these are actually what? Time to finish in seconds. 13.4 second, 14.1 second, and 15.2 second. These are the time taken by these athletes to finish this. So actually, it is of the same data, but data is expressed in four different ways. So that is also possible. It depends upon what type of analysis we are focusing on. Now, why these scales are very important? Because suppose we are having a data on a nominal scale, right? Nominal scale, the first scale, nominal scale. Then what type of statistic analysis is possible? We are having a data. So for that, we can use frequency counts. Then percentage, obviously, along with that, this is frequency distribution table. Then out of your mean, median, mode is possible. Mode is what? The highest frequency data, right? So the frequency can be measured. So mode is possible. And basic graphs and diagrams are possible. Your pie diagram, percentage, bar diagram, multiple bar diagram, right? Even histogram is also possible when we go for this type of data, right? So for nominal scale, we are allowed to use this. Please remember this. I'll be sharing these slides with you. But whenever there is a question on nominal scale, these statistics are possible. Out of this allowed statistics, you can use any.
Sorry, sir, to interrupt, but when I'm talking about ratio scale, sir, so you
madam,
said
salary. Please wait. I'll be coming to the ratio scale, then you ask question. Okay. I'm explaining each and every scale. Please wait. Let me come to the ratio scale. Okay. So this is the first thing. And there are a few things which you can remember about the nominal scale. The second scale is, these are examples of nominal scale. Okay. And the second scale is an ordinal scale. Now, what is possible in the ordinal scale? In the ordinal scale, we are having all those things which are allowed in the nominal is again possible. So you can have frequency distribution, you can have percentage, you can have mode, you can have pi diagrams, etc. In addition to that, you can use percentile, quartile, and median as your statistics. Okay, so this is an additional one. So in addition to the earlier one, percentile, quartile, because there is an order, and median is what? Middlemost value of an organized data. So median is possible. Okay. So then this is an example of ordinal scale.
Sorry to disturb you, sir. Can you show the nominal scale slide once for a minute, sir?
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So all those things are possible. In addition to that, percentile, quartile, and median is possible. Right? Percentile, quartile, and median is possible. So in short, for first type and second type scale, which are categorical things, right? We can prepare frequency distribution table, mean, median, quartile, percentiles are possible as a statistical tools, right? Along with that, along with range also is possible, that I have not added that. But in fact, you can use this particular one, and these two scales are very important. The ordinal scale, the order is very important, less than 5 minutes, 5 to 4, these are also options, right? These are categories, but there is some logical order. This is what I'm talking about. Yeah. And the third scale is an interval scale, where all those rating scale, ranking, as well as, your agreement scale, Likert-like scales, 10 point, 5 point, 7 point, right, all those scales will come under this category. Here, all those previous statistical tools are possible. In addition to that, right, arithmetic mean, standard deviation, and other commonly used statistics in research like correlation regression. If there is a bivariate situation, we can comparison. For comparison, both the scales should be interval. Then correlation regressions also possible. So, in addition to that, this is possible. Okay. So this is an example of an interval scale. Will definitely not buy extremely likely. So there is like Likert sort of thing, those scales, likely scale it is. So this type of scales are coming under this interval scale. In some books, you will find interval and ordinal taken together also, right? Some authors consider them together, but I generally do it separately. And the last scale is ratio scale, where numeric data is taken into the consideration. For numeric data, all possible statistical techniques, everything is possible. So when you are having a direct data, right, you need not bother about scales particularly. Okay, so for this thing. Now somebody is asking on ratio scale question. Please ask question now.
Yeah, so as you said, it is salary, but sometimes we write income also and we give them a category like this to this, approximately this income.
Exactly. That is what I precisely said. It is up to you. The way you are asking question, the scale will be decided accordingly. If you are giving income groups, right, it becomes an categorical question. It may be an ordinal scale. But if you are directly asking income, right, then it
becomes
a ratio scale.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Same question can be asked in two different ways. See, if you want to really analyze an actual, you don't want groups, you want actual salary or actual income, then you have to ask question on the ratio scale. But if you are not much bothered about the actual, it may be okay if it is in the range, then your groups, right? That's okay. So it's comfort, like our comfort, researcher comfort. Okay, this is a direct question. Now I will take you to a questionnaire. I expect all of you to participate in this particular process. I'll be asking you the scale of a question, and please do it very quickly so that the time will be saved. Right? This is very important just to check whether you have understood the concept clearly or not. Right? So this is a questionnaire I have prepared. This is related to a financial literacy survey. We'll talk more about this questionnaire later on. Let us not talk about the questionnaire preparation, but general scale, right? So I expect everyone to, simultaneously. Okay, so yes. Yeah, please. Okay, I'll do simultaneously because things are not seen simultaneously on the screen. Yeah, look at the first question, the first group category, age group. Now you need to tell me what is the scale. There are four scales, right? Four scales. What are four scales? Nominal, ordinal, right? Interval and ratio. We will use short forms, N for nominal, O for ordinal, I for interval and R for ratio. So you have to look at the question, look at carefully and type the scale in your chat box quickly. First question, age group. What is the scale? Age group. What are four types of scales? Nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. Nominal, ordinal,
interval.
I think there is little confusion. Little confusion. Okay, so let me explain once again. This is what I actually want to see. Remember that interval scale is used only for rating and those questions where there are special, like agreement scale, satisfaction scale, right? All those scales are used. So other cases may this particular scale is not used. Nominal is the scale where categories are options, but categories can be interchanged. Any order, order is not important. But in case of ordinal, order is important. Now please let me know what are your answers with what is the scale of the same question. I expect now correct answer from you. Very good. Yes, it is ordinal. Most of you are getting correct answer. It is ordinal. Why it is ordinal? Because there is an order here. 19 to 24. After that, 25 to 30. After that, 31 to 36. I can reverse the order, but I cannot mix the order. Right? So an age group is a categorical. It is not age. It is age group. Right? So there is no question of interval. Even if it looks like an interval, please remember this is not class interval sort of thing. That is what some people got confused with. This is either ordinal or nominal. But why it is ordinal? Because there is an order. Gender. Quickly now. Gender. Gender. gender, nominal, very good, nominal, fantastic. Gender is a nominal because I can change the order. Absolutely. Third, highest educational level. Look at this carefully. Highest educational level. Less than graduate, graduate, postgraduate, MPhil or PhD. MPhil or PhD. Yes. Ordinal, ordinal, ordinal. Fantastic. All of you are getting correct answers. Fantastic. Next variable, marital status. Married and unmarried. Okay, now. Most of you are getting nominal. Somebody wrote ordinal. There is no order here, right? I can change. I can change the order. Definitely not ratio. Definitely not ratio. Definitely not ratio. It is nominal scale. It is nominal scale. Yes, let us go for some more questions. Community type, urban, suburban, and rural. First of all, remember that all these are categories. So first two types will come, right? Most of the time. Nominal and ordinal. Whether order is important here or not, that we have to check. If order is not important, then what is the scale now? Yes, for this question. But you have to decide one. Two scales are not possible. Now see, urban, suburban, rural. I can start with rural. I can write suburban. I can write urban first. So there is no order here. Please remember, there is no order here. So this is nominal scale. This is nominal scale. Okay. Community type is over. Occupation. Student, housewife, professional, service, self-employed, others, right? Yes, what is the scale now? Nominal, because there is no order. Now people are getting, okay, good. Fine, let's proceed further. Total work experience. Somebody is asking question on work experience. None, less than 2 years, 2 to 4 years. These are groups, please remember. Total work experience, group. So the scale of this question, scale, yes, yes, very good. Most of you are getting correct answer. It's an ordinal scale. There's an order here. Now you are getting approximate annual salary. Approximate annual salary. Come on, quickly. Approximate annual salary. Ordinal. Fantastic. Fantastic. Most of you are getting now correct answer. Ordinal. There is an order here. Okay. Yeah. Let us proceed further. Then there is a table here. There are statements. Right? There are statements. And the options are strongly agree, agree. That is agreement scale. Now, pura complete table is there. So for this complete table, what is this scale? For this complete table, what is this scale now? Yes, interval. Very good. Now you have understood. Whenever there is a such scale, it is an interval scale. Interval scale. Yes, yes. Now you have understood the concept, interval scale. And let me just show you. There are questions like this. Let us not spend time on this. Question number 8. Question number 8. Number of credit cards in your name, number of debit cards. What is the scale of this question? Number of credit cards and number of? Yes, ratio. Fantastic. You have understood now. Right? So this is how, actually, whenever you prepare a questionnaire, you have to note the scale of each and every question properly. So that the respective analysis you can do. Once you know the scale, the analysis, you can definitely work out with the, you can select definitely what you want from those possible things. Thank you very much for, you know, quick participation in this particular process, right? So you have understood the, this is very important thing initially. You have spent a lot of time on this, but this is very important, essential part, I feel. So that is what I spend a lot of time. Let's proceed further now. Okay, so This is on measurement scales, right? Primary scales and this thing. Now, let's talk about questionnaire a little bit. I'm not going to talk much on this questionnaire. It's a formalized set of questions obtaining the information. Please remember that it must translate the whole information. Now, there are a lot of questions on number of questions, right? Number of how many questions should be there in a questionnaire. There is no answer for this question because it's up to the respondent, up to the researcher, what data that the researcher wants to collect. Accordingly, you have to frame the question. But go for closed-ended question. Now, what is the difference between closed-ended and open-ended? Closed-ended means answers are available, and open-ended means you have an open question. For example, what do you feel about the present economic scenario? So somebody will give you a big answer like this. So those type of questions are coming under the open-ended. So if you really required open-ended, then only you go for open-ended question. Otherwise, keep it simple. And all those structured questions you prepare. Structured means all those closed-ended questions. Okay, so it should be a structured and having a minimum response error. Now, this is very important. Now, let me just show you something interesting. When you prepare a questionnaire, these few things you remember with you. I am not going to talk about completely about questionnaire preparation, but few things. First of all, you have to study these primary scales, which you have already done, right? And other relevant, there are certain other scales like Likert scale and satisfaction scale, Likert-like scale. Those scales also you should be aware of. Then prepare general questions or a demographic profile questions. General questions are those questions related to age and educational qualifications, work experience, etc., etc. So prepare these questions while before preparing the any, and note the scale of those questions. Those questions as well as the questions which we are going to prepare later on. Then select questions scale for each of this question related to the demographic. Now you focus on objective. Say for example, you are having four objectives in front of you. So prepare questions related to all four objectives one by one. Take first objective, prepare questions. Now these questions can be on any scale, nominal, ordinal, ratio, according to your requirement, prepare those questions, right? And just in the bracket, you write down O, N, I, right? Whatever is the scale of that question. That is what called a select question scale as a nominal, ordinal, or interval. Generally, first three scales are used for objective verification. You may definitely go for a ratio scale also for objective verification. It's not an issue at all, but generally we go for these three. Objectives are verified. Objectives are verified. Objective verification. And hypotheses are tested, right? This is verification. Right? Objectives are verified and hypotheses are generally tested. Right? Just remember this. Hypotheses are tested. So when hypotheses are tested, for that you need to have a proper scale. So what you do is, you prepare questions related to hypothesis. You may have mixed also objective hypothesis together because generally object hypotheses are related to the objectives. So you may have those questions in between also. But you need questions on hypothesis. If at all you are going to test your hypothesis using primary data, if you are testing using secondary data, you need a relevant data from the secondary sources. Then select question scale, generally interval and ratio. For testing, we generally use interval and ratio. Obviously, nominal, ordinal scale can be used because there are certain tests like chi-square test can be used for nominal, ordinal, interval data also. But most of the hypothesis, t-test, z-test, ANOVA and all, we require interval and ratio. So remember this, that either you use interval or ratio. And then finally, organize your question in a logical order, making different sections. You may make sections objective-wise, right? It is up to you the way you want, but you can definitely go for this. Okay, so this thing, few things you remember while, so scale is important for the analysis. So you should know this scale. After that, you should pre-test your questionnaire. Pre-testing is very important. You generally do it in the pilot and prepare a pilot analysis and pilot study report also. while doing this pre-testing, nowadays we are having Google Forms option, right? So we don't know where we are sending the questionnaire. So please situate that at least pre-testing you will do directly by personal interview, because you need to explain the respondent what is the purpose of your study properly, and then you should know whom you are asking selection, that proper sample selection has to be done. So that for that reason you need to have personal interview. Then make certain changes wherever required, and pre-test and finally for this. You have to analyze the pre-tested data also, pilot data, because nowadays we require a pilot study report. Pilot study report is necessary, right? So that is why you have to remember for pre-testing. Then reliability and validity of a questionnaire tool, right? As a tool, you have already there. I suppose that in the earlier session, this has been discussed, reliability and validity. So I'm not going in the detail, but I have added some content of that for your reference. Okay, reliability and validity, you have to go for, right? So reliability, there are different types of reliability, test, pre-test, alternative form reliability, the internal consistency. What I'm going to show today is how to go for this internal consistency reliability using Kronebach alpha. We call it as a coefficient of alpha. Please remember, the value less than 0.6 is generally unsatisfactory internal consistent reliability. So whenever you check reliability, your alpha value has to be greater than 6, greater than 0.6, not 6, 0.6, right? 0.7 and above is ideally good, and 0.8 and above is almost always best, right? So you have to decide this number, you remember, just go for 0.7 and above, that is always treated as good. But 0.6 and above is also considered as fine, right? Fine things, okay sort of thing, internal. So I'm going to show you today with the software how to go for internal tests. Similarly, validity, one has to test contained validity, criterion validity, and convergent validity. Convergent validity, construct validity, sorry, where convergent and discriminant validity can be tested by just using simple correlations among the statements. Find out the correlations among the statements and decide about the convergent validity. In case of a group, say for example in a questionnaire, just take you to the questionnaire. What is this? Say for example, here we are having a scale. Right? This is a group. Financial self-efficacy is a variable, sub-variable you may call it as, and there are 7 statements. Now, within these statements, there should be a good correlation. Within this statement, there should be a good correlation, right? And for that, what you can do is you can apply this particular convergent validity. Other measures, same construct. And suppose you are having, say, financial self-efficacy is one construct, and attitude towards money is another construct. These are different things, but they should be there should not be any good correlations to segregate them also. But finally, that they should be independent in short, right? So that is what this particular consistency or validity part of this has to be taken care of. Okay, so now the basic part related to this thing is okay. Now let me just move towards the descriptive and inferential analysis. We are ready now for descriptive and inferential analysis. I hope the concept of population and sample is okay with everybody. Population is all units. Voice has become faint, not clear. Am I audible clearly? Somebody is sending a message.
Sir, to us you are very much audible, but one or two participants have written down that your voice is not clear to them.
Maybe an internet issue for
them. Can we hear from some other participants whether sir's voice is clear? Because I can hear sir very clearly. Can you please?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, clear, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear clearly.
Very you. Nice. Thank you. Yeah. So those who cannot hear, sir, can you please check your audio system then? Because majority, everybody is saying sir is very clear. Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Okay. So, population is actually all units, right? But remember that population does not mean human being every time. It can be any units of study. Suppose you somebody is studying something about trees, right? So different types of species of trees. So that tree will be a part of population, not a human being. Okay, so it depends upon what you are studying. And then sample is a part of population, a representative. I'm not talking about sampling techniques and how to sample, but definitely one thing let me tell you, there are a lot of questions about sample size, right? I have shared one file with you, right, in my Google Drive, which the link of which I'm going to share with you, where material I'm sharing. In that file, right, you will see a sample size situation. So let us not spend time on that. If at the end of the session, suppose the little time, then I'll definitely talk about those things. Yeah. So those things I'll talk later on. Let me just proceed for that. Yeah. Now statistical tools. Generally, as I said, there are two types of analysis. Descriptive analysis we are going to use for objective verification, and inferential analysis we are going to use for hypothesis testing. For descriptive analysis, we use a frequency table with percentage, cross tables, graphs, diagrams, then mean, median, mode, standard deviation, mean deviation, right? All these things we are generally used for, descriptive analysis. Okay, then measures of skewness and kurtosis also are used for descriptive analysis along with the correlation and regression. But correlation and regressions, we don't just stop there only. We go for a correlation test and regression test further. So it will not be just used as a descriptive analysis, but descriptive as well as inferential analysis in most of the cases, because regression test and correlation test one has to use properly. In inferential analysis, there are two types of tests, parametric and non-parametric, depending upon the data is normally distributed or not. We are going to talk a lot about this in this particular session now, right? Parametric as well as non-parametric test. I'll show you how to select a test, which test is used for what ideal scenario, right? And at the same time, the testing also, I'll show you how to use a software. So all these things is our focus now. So we are ready now for the statistical analysis. So let us proceed further now for descriptive and the inferential analysis. So I'm introducing now a software called as Jamovi. There are different softwares. Somebody may just start with Excel add-in we are having called as data analysis. If you are aware, you can use data analysis Excel add-in also. With Google Sheets also, Google Sheet has analysis software. So nowadays Google Sheets can be used for analysis, but those are very basic things. For actually research, you are not, that is not sufficient. Then there is an additional software Excel add-in called as Megastat. Megastat Excel add-in, that can be used also, right? So Megastat, which is an Excel add-in, that is also possible. SPSS is a very popular software, right? I generally conduct workshops on SPSS also, but that is a paid software. So people find it very difficult to get that software. Of course, try
so FAMTLS.
What is this?
FAMTLS. That is SPSS.
SPSS is a software.
So that is SEMPLS. SEMPLS, I'm asking. Is it SPSS,
No, SPSS is a different one, right? You're talking about different software.
Okay, sir.
What about Basarstat?
Yeah, there are many softwares, right? There are many softwares, but I'm using generally either SPSS or this Jamovi one. I don't know whether you are aware of Jamovi.
We heard for the first time, sir.
Yeah, fine. So that's good. First time, then you will really enjoy this, right? And you like also, right? So it's a very interesting software. And why it is very interesting? Because an SPSS data file can be open and worked out in Jamovi. Some people must be aware of R also, right? R, right? So R file can be opened here, not opened actually. R coding is not required. Your file the output can be generated in R also. R output can be generated. So that's versatile one, right? Okay, not only that, I think Python is also, Python output can be generated using this. I'm not sure, I never worked out on that, but R I have worked out. So any file you open, and you know, very interestingly, Excel file can be opened directly. You just have to convert that Excel file into CSV file. CSV is another version of Excel, right? So that CSV version you have to convert into, right? And then you can start working with this particular one. I'm going to show that now. It's very interesting software, Jamovi. So when you actually go to a website, right, what is the website? Jamovi.org, right? And you go to the download, you will find this type of things, right? There you can have a download option here, download option. And once you go, in fact, if you go to the proper side of download, you will find out different versions of this particular. This is actually a website, right? Website, I'm going to click it now. So this is actually, there are different versions. The version which I'm using is the older version, which I've downloaded last year rather. Now that is no more available, but it is still working, there is no problem. This current version, this right hand side 1.8.1, right, you can download in your system. Generally we go for a Windows because most of you are having Windows. So the first one, 1.8.1 you download, right? There are certain system requirements. You may take help of your friend from the IT department to do all these things, right? That is always better. If you are not, somebody send a message in the first day only morning, I mean, when we have started that time. So, but I advise you people to go for this. Don't worry about this thing. You can download very quickly. Little effort you have to take. And then system requirement is very important. If you are having trouble, just check your system requirement. And if you forget how to download and all, there is a YouTube link here, right? You have to go to the YouTube link. Initially, it should start with an advertisement, so you need not bother. Later on, this is a YouTube where everything is explained, starting from downloading the software and the complete analysis. I think it is 4.5 hours video, which is available on YouTube. So if you forget, go to this particular link and just type Jamovi video, probably you will land up there only. Okay, or go to this particular, this is I'm going to share. Okay, so you can download it directly. Just have to click here, current version 1.8.1 for your Windows, and then go ahead with this thing. Right, there won't be any issues. Right, or you take help of somebody. We got this page. What page? Okay. I'm taking to the site, taking you all of you to that particular site. See, now this is how it looks like. Okay. So this is the current version which you have to download. That's it for Windows. Suppose somebody is having a Mac system or a Linux, then accordingly you have to go for it. And there is system requirement also that you have to go through. Or you just Google it, right, and find out the relevant information and download. Very simple. It won't take more than 5 to 10 minutes if the things are okay, right, to download the software. And then you have to run that software so that it will be seen properly like this in your system, right? Say, for example, I'm having a Jamovi 1.1.9.0. This is an old version. Now it is 1.8.2, right? This is the current one. Current one you will find out this now. You can download this. Okay. Yes. So. And then YouTube video, just go through it alone. Now, how to open It is not SPSS file, it is JAMOVI file. Sorry for this. Let me make correction. JAMOVI file, okay. Yeah, from Excel. So that's what we are going to learn now. First of all, let me take you to the Excel file and how to convert into CSV file. I'll take you now. Suppose there is an Excel file. Forget what is the content of this file for the moment. This is an Excel file. Okay. This is an Excel file. Now what I want is, I want to open this file in convert this file into CSV file. So save as, very standard procedure, save as. I'm saving this file on a desktop. Right, by default, it is Excel workbook. By default, it is Excel workbook, but I don't want this particular one. I want, let me just save here. Okay. By default, it is Excel workbook, but I want to save it as an CSV file. Now, there are different CSV versions. We have to use this CSV, note down this, CSV, delimited. CSV, delimited version, right? This particular one, you have to convert it. Only then, this particular file will work in this particular software. So, CSV, delimited. Okay, select this. Now it is CSV, delimited, and save this file. Now this file will be saved on the desktop. Now see, this is a folder which I have created. If you look at these two files, right, there is a small difference in the icon, right? Excel, they look very similar, but this is one CSV one. You can definitely identify by looking at the name also. See, here it is, Microsoft Excel, separated value. CSV, because long form is what? Comma separated values. So we have to convert into CSV file. Now this file, I can definitely open in SPSS. So everything, whatever data you are having, you have to create your data sheet in Excel, and that data sheet you will open in JAMOVI using this file. So now let me take you to that particular one, how to open a particular file. It is simple. Yes. So I have a CSV file, which I've shown you just now. Now let me open this CSV file. Again, I will show you. This is my CSV file. Okay. I'm going to open this CSV file in JAMOVI. So for that, I have to start my JAMOVI. So I will open my JAMOVI. It will take few seconds to start. Right? Generally, when you start, it will take few seconds to start. My software is getting activated. And once the software is activated, I can open my file from the location. Now you have to create an Excel file, keep it in a proper location so that that file can be opened. Excuse me for a few seconds, please. It is taking time. Only at the initial stage, it will take time. But once it is ready, This is how it look like. This is how it look like. This is a blank file. Left hand side, you will find out Excel sort of thing. And on the right hand side, an output window. Here, there is a message. Since I'm having an old version, so I could see this message. They're asking me to update the version, but I have not updated it. Doesn't matter. It is still working properly, right? So then what you will do is, now this is open. This is a blank file. So I'll go to the left-hand side option, right? Generally, left-hand side corner, open. I'll say open. Open. And then I'll be going to my locations. Locations. Okay, in my location, I have saved some file, but my file is here. Now you'll see there was another file in this folder, which is Excel file. Excel file is not seen at all because it is not possible to open. So only the CSV version of the Excel file is seen here. So I can just click on this, right, and open. Yes, the file is open. File is open. Right, file is open this way. Just I'll just proceed further for a moment, little bit, right, and then do something, right, with this file. So this file is open. This is how we open the file. Let me just take you to the reliability test in this file. I want to test the reliability of my tool, a questionnaire, right? And generally we select the questions which are on the scale for the reliability. Scale matlab agreement scale. All those scale questions, interval scale rather, right? So we select. So in my questionnaire, you know, this is a section where there are scaled questions. So I'm going to select. Now, first variable is financial self-efficacy. I want to check the reliability of this portion or this part. I may, the overall reliability also I'll be selecting. I'll be checking. But this portion, these six statements together, there's a variable called as financial self-efficacy. I want to check the reliability of this portion. Now, how I'm going to check the reliability? Let us see. So the same questionnaire, I have actually collected a data of certain respondents, right? And that data is taken here. About the same questionnaire. This is actually collected from a Google form and then converted into the course. Then I have generated a variable called as, this is not a good one. Let me not take you to this file. I'll close this file. Something is missing in this file. The one which I've opened, something is missing. That is the reason why I'm opening the another one. I hope this is perfectly all right. Yeah. So these original questions I wanted. That was another file which I've opened. I wanted this. Now here, section 2A1. Now the section 2A1 represent my first statement. 2A1. 2A2, 2A3, 2A4. So I've just given some short forms, short variables for this to represent the statements. I want to check the reliability of these six statements together as a group called as, or a variable called as financial self-efficacy. So how do I go ahead with this thing? Let me go. Now here somewhere you will see factors. Where you have to go? You have to go to factors, I think. I've explained here. You have to go to factors and then factor. You go to factor, right? Open a file, go to factor. I've explained the procedure. So when you will get this PPT, you will remember, you will get this particular link also, logic also. So go to the factors. Factor is available here. Then reliability. Otherwise, if you forget, just keep on clicking on this portion. You will understand where is your reliability analysis. Here you will see reliability analysis. I click on this reliability analysis. So on the right hand side, something was calculated, right? So don't worry about this thing. It will be a blank one on the right hand side. And once you click, right, something will happen here like this. Now you will see actually when you start working, you will see something like this after clicking on the reliability analysis. Coronavirus alpha is already default, it is set it. Setting is there, so that is already there. Now what you do is, you have to select these statements. Factor analysis. Factor reliability analysis. So now this statement, six statements, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This form the first group. So I'm just transferring this particular to the right hand side. Now when I'm doing this, automatically something happened here, right? So that Cronenberg alpha is already generated. But along with this, you select an item statistics like this. First one, Cronenberg alpha is atom dropped. Now what is this? Let me explain first, right? Let me explain this first. Okay, what is this Cronenberg alpha? Cronenberg alpha is the parameter which I was talking about, right? If you go back for the reliability test, right? When I was talking about the reliability here, it is internal consistency reliability. In this, we are having Cronenberg alpha, right? This, the value of this alpha has to be greater than 0.6, right? For a satisfactory one. If it is less than that, it will be an unsatisfactory or the reliability is not good, right? So that is what we say. So yes. In this particular case, what has happened? Let's see what happens in this case. What is value? 0.777. Now, the scale of this particular portion is, let me know whether the scale is reliable or not. What is your opinion? Once again, I will show you. The Cronenberg alpha is 0.777. Now, I need your opinion whether the scale for this particular variable is reliable or not. Reliable. Very good. Why? Because it has to be greater than 0.6. Greater than 0.6. Fine. Good. Thank you. Now, suppose it is not greater than 0.6. Suppose it is not greater than 0.6. 0.5, 0.55. Now the problem, so the problem may be in the statement part, right? The group of that particular statement. One of the statement may be creating a problem, right? So that statement we may have to eliminate. We may have to eliminate because that statement may not be a part of that particular group. Okay, right? That financial literacy variable is not actually representing that statement is not representing that particular variable. So there is a chance that there is a mistake. So that is why we have created this atom reliability statistics, right? If atom dropped. Now what is this actually, this number indicates? This number indicates that if I drop a particular statement, so if I drop particular first statement, then the reliability value will change to 0.722, right? Whereas this is already 0.777. So yeah, acha hai, high end. So I need not bother to change it, right? In fact, I am not, in this case, I need not do anything because already it is reliable. Suppose it is less than 0.6, 0.52 aata hai, or 0.4 aa jata hai, whatever it is. Then you have to look at this portion and see. Say for example, this third A4, what is this? 2A4. This is, if I am removing this, deleting this from this particular group, then what will be the reliability value? 0.825. This is improving, 0.825. Let me show you. What I do is, I will just transfer this variable to the left hand side. Now there are 5, that 2A4 is not there. Now look at the value, Cronenberg alpha value. It is 0.825. So this way, you have to look at the table down below and check which statement we should eliminate to increase the reliability. And accordingly, you remove that. And now your reliability is this, right? Which is actually the requirement if suppose. Then what you do? Then you keep all these five statements in your questionnaire, final questionnaire, and remove that. So what you do is generally in the pilot study, you do this pre-testing, you do this reliability test and check whether your questionnaire tool is prepared properly or not, looking at the reliability concept. Right? There is one more thing that is called as correlation heat map. Now let me just add this correlation heat map. Right? Now this will also help you to decide about. So remember that when statements are forming a one particular group or a one particular tool, right, then there should be a positive correlation, a good amount of positive correlation. Here you will see that the process may, everything is positive, good amount of positive correlation between statement one, statement two, statement three. In fact, I can bring back my statement number four also, because that with that also there's no problem, right? So I brought that statement number four, right? Then also this correlation will be positive. This correlation will just to help you to understand whether there is a good amount of correlation or not, right? So if you look at the last one, 2A4, the amount of correlation is small as compared to the other correlation values. This is Karl-Pearson values. So these values are smaller, and that is why if I remove that, there will be stronger correlation between the statements. Yes, is it okay how to test the reliability? Have you understood how to test the reliability? Please reply. It is not that difficult. Yes, very good. What you remember, 0.7 and above is the best one. 0.6 and above is good one. 0.8 and above is the best, right? Ultimate. If you are getting 0.8 and above, it is ultimate. But 0.7 mil jata hai, so don't unnecessarily change it, right? So if it is below 0.6, you eliminate the statement. Otherwise, you keep it as it is. Okay. Then second part of the questionnaire is also, there is one more variable. So I can take all those 7-8 statements which are related. I can check the reliability. Third part, 7 statements. Fourth part, this thing. And then finally, the complete reliability of this particular as a one variable, because all these are related to the financial attitude. Giving financial attitude, sir, as well.
Sir, may I ask you?
Just a minute. Sir. So what we have to do is you have to just transfer all statements together and then find out the reliability of the complete tool also. So complete tool, we have to take the reliability of this particular part. Yes, you may ask question now.
Sir, can we download analysis in or import this with Excel like this? Whatever outcome has come.
Yeah, I'm coming to that point. Okay, very good.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
What we can do is, can't download. Please don't worry about download now. Don't ask me question about download. You have to sort out. It is not difficult. Thoda sa kuch system issue.
No, download. No, I just wanted to ask you the output as we can in SPSS. We can import like that. Yes. Here we can also. Yeah.
Wait.
Thank you, sir.
Asking question regarding download. That's what I was answering. Okay. Somebody else asked question regarding download. Yeah. I'm coming to that point. Can we? Now, our question is, can we import this, right? Export this. Yes. What you can do is, there are two ways. If I what I'm doing is right click on your mouse. Then you will see export and copy. Best way is to copy, because export will not come properly sometimes. So copy. So I can copy paste. If I want to copy these three things together, what I will do is, I will go here and done click. So what will happen? Everything will be copied together. Just copy, right? And then go to your Word file, a new Word file, or Excel, wherever you want. You can test it. And this is possible table-wise or together. But only thing is that table which you get, right, you have to do little modification. Formatting.
Sir, yes. Sir, sorry to ask you again. Yes. In between. Hello.
Yeah, please.
Sir, as you did na right click, I am also doing with you, along with you. I am also trying to do right click, but it's not like supporting.
It will.
Only we have to do right click anywhere or what?
On the table on the right hand side of that portion. I'm doing it once again. See here, can you see my mouse arrow? Is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Right portion. Just right click here.
I don't know. In my system, it's not supporting. Maybe some problem.
Possible, right? I'm just copying this now. Copied this on a document, right? Now this is that particular. These all three things are there now with me. Copied it, and then you have to modify. You have to make proper this thing table and everything border border dena padega something like that. So that modifications you have to do later on. Okay, so then you know adjust this table and etc. This we have to do even in sometimes in the SPSS output we have to do this. So it's no problem. You can copy anywhere. You can copy in Excel also. You can make a PDF also. Right? So absolutely no problem. Coming on right click. Yeah, it is. It will come. Right? It will come. You have to try. That's it. Yeah, so now this is possible, and don't go for the other parameters, other things, you know, because this is an advanced software, so it will give you so many other things which you require. What you need is just you need these two things to remember. I'm just keeping it simple, right? So that it will help you for your further understanding. Now, let us proceed further. Reliability test. I'm just sharing the output also. Right, heat map also. Now for objective verification, as I told you, we need to understand basic things. Now let me just scroll through these basic things. Generally, any numeric data has got characteristics, three characteristics: central tendency, dispersion, and the shape. Right. So what are the central tendency measures? Mean, median, mode. Or most of you are aware of this. So. Mean median mode, and you know what to calculate for what scale and all we have discussed. Then measures of variation may range, then other one is called as absolute mean deviation, standard deviation, variance coefficient of variation. This is mostly used. We use standard deviation most of the time and the variance also. There is something called as skewness. These are actually, this will give you the shape of a data. This is very important. What you do is whenever you start analysis of a numeric data, the data can be converted into numeric coding. You have to give code and convert into numbers. Computer understand numbers. So this is very important. You have to find out the skewness. You have to draw the graph, right? And if the graph is slanting towards left hand side, it is called as left skewed. If it is slanting towards the right hand side, it is called as right skewed. And if it is giving equal, it is symmetric, then it is called as symmetric or normal data. So the middle is normal, and the left hand side is not normal. Right hand side is also not normal. So this normality actually is required to do every time. We need not draw this, right? But you look at the mean, median, mode values and decide. Generally, median lies between mean and mode. If they are approximately equal, it is symmetric. If the side on which mean lies is actually the skewness. If mean is right on the right hand side, it is right skew. If mean on the left hand side of this particular equation relationship, then it is left hand side skew. But there are certain statistical tests also. In fact, with software, we just use tests to check the normality, whether data is normal or not. Remember that when data is normal, we are going to use one type of test. When data is not normal, we are going to use another type of test in the statistical testing. So three things. One is central tendency, mean median mode. Other one is standard deviation, mean deviations, etc. That is dispersion. And third one is shape. These three things, these are the three characteristics of your, or we call it as a descriptive characteristics. Along with that, we will be going for correlation and regression as well as. So before going to the correlation, let's go to the frequency table. How to generate a frequency table from these Jamovi software, right? Frequency table, all of you are aware. So let's go to the Jamovi software, the same file I'm using. The other one I will use now. This one I'm using. I want frequency table, right? I want frequency table. For example, for gender, for highest educational qualification, occupation, total work experience. I've selected some variables in this file. And for this, I need what? I need my tables, right? Frequency distribution table. Now, how to go ahead with this thing? What question? So go to the exploration. If you forget, just click. Don't worry. Then you will find out descriptive. Descriptive. Okay. Descriptive. So there you go for a descriptive. Now, in descriptive, we are having frequency tables. We are having statistics, mean, median, mode, and then plots also. Right? Plots may, we are having histogram. Box plot, right, etc., etc., which are generally simple bar diagram, pie diagrams are not actually possible here. Somebody was asking a question, but histogram, box plot, bar plots, bar plot is possible rather, right? But pie diagram is not possible. So that we can work out, obviously, with the Excel answer. So these possibilities are there. So let me take variables called as gender. Highest education qualification, occupation, and the four variables. You know that mean, median, mode are not possible for all of them, right? You have to go to the scale properly and check what statistics are possible. I'm just showing you exactly how to prepare a frequency table. So just click on the frequency table part, frequency table, and these frequency tables are generated. Here immediately frequency table with percentage, cumulative percentage, like SPSS. Those who are using SPSS, they'll understand the similar type of tables are obtained, you can obtain from the SPSS. But what is advantage here, you don't have to look at the output and input shift. Here directly on the right hand side, you'll be able to see everything. Right? Obviously, someone can, you know, copy this, right? There are two ways. If you want to copy everything, just go to the right hand side of this particular box. Sorry. Right here, right hand side, click. And if you want to select a proper table, go to the table and click. So when I go to the table and click, I'm just copying. I can copy this. If I want complete all tables together, I can copy on the right hand side. Same way as I shown you, right? You can copy this. Now, somebody want a particular distribution. For example, let me take gender outside from this particular file. Now, what I will do is, I will find out the distribution of highest education level gender wise, that is male and female separately. I can do that, obviously. This is split by, just like a cross table. Just like a cross table, right? This way you can prepare a cross table. See now, all those which are selected here are actually given this particular. Okay, gender wise, you can prepare. Similarly, occupation wise, experience wise, community type wise, the way you want, you can prepare the tables and have this particular one. Okay, yeah, there is another option also to prepare bivariate or cross table also. That I will show you. You have to go to the frequencies here. And then there is independent sample chi-square test of association. In this, it is also possible to prepare a chi-square distribution. Cross tables, okay. This is for cross tables particularly. Two ways of preparation of cross table. But this cross table will give you about, along with the chi-square value. Right? Why chi-square value is important, we'll come to that point, so that moment, that moment that is going. I hope how to go for a frequency table is okay with all of you. How to go for frequency tables, right? There is another file also, frequency table. You have to then copy paste, properly convert it, and then you get this out. You may have mean median mode also. Now let me go to the descriptive statistics mean median mode. So I'll go to the another file, which I've already added one more file. So okay. So there is another file I'm opening. All these files I've shared with you, right? I'm going to share with you in a drive. So you'll get those things also for working purpose. Yes, this is a very simple file where there are two columns, right? Two columns, F and T. This is a sales data of two salesmen, right? Right, previous month and the next month, right? So that's what it means, followed month. I just want to calculate a mean median mode. So I'll be going for mean median mode. So again, go to the descriptive, right? Descriptive, and I'll calculate mean median. Now, once you are comfortable with this software, you can do anything with this software. Very simple it is. Both variable I took, descriptive. Now, I don't want frequency table. I want mean median mode. So, accordingly, I'll select, say, mean mode, median mode, already by default, standard deviation, variance, skewness, good process. And very interestingly, here we are having normality test also. This is what I was talking about. Inbuilt normality test also. So this data is normal or not, that can be decided also. I'll tell you after a few minutes how to decide the normality. But this data can be generated quickly, right? So now everything we have calculated, you just have to right click now and copy that table, right? Right click, copy this table wherever you want. Accordingly, you can use it for your study. You can delete them. Once you are in a Word, right, or in Excel, right, you can delete, add whatever you want, right? Unnecessary rows and columns, you may just arrange it. Okay, this way you can go for descriptive mean median mode. Mean median mode. Right, the same thing I have just added some snapshots here, right, for your reference. The same thing which I have selected is seen here, you will see. And the table also, right? The same table now here. Now here I have highlighted this Shapiro-Wilk P. Now this is normality test. So there are two datas, no? I just wanted to check a normality, whether data is normal, data set is normal or not. Two columns are there. So you have to remember that this value, this is P value. This P value means probability value. This p-value should be greater than 0.05. Somewhere you note down, for normality test, p should be greater than 0.05, which is actually significant level, right? And so both these cases, the p-value is, this is actually percentage-wise, if you want to convert, it is 76.7% multiplied by 100. So this is 76% and this is 24%. So obviously greater than 5%. So when it is greater, we call it normal distribution. So both F and P data in this case are normal distribution. We are going to talk about normality every moment when we look for a hypothesis. Now go to the, let us go to the correlation scatter diagram first of all. So let me take you to the another file once again. I will have to close some files because multiple files will create a problem. Yeah, let me close this first of all. Okay, now I want to open my correlation file. So I am having a separate file called as correlation. Let me open it now. It's not directly opening. Open. I have a correlation and regression. Because scatter diagram is generally used for correlation and regression analysis. Yeah, there are four variables here: preference, nutrition, test, and preservation, quality preservation. Now, this is related to a particular food item, say, for example, and these are ratings, 7-point scale ka ratings hai. 7 is high and 1 is low. The preference is actually depends on the nutritional value of a product, test, as well as preservation quality. So, I want to find out preservation and preference, whether they are related or not. So, what do I do now? I'll go to the exploration and scatter plot. First of all, I'll find out whether there is any correlation which I can understand from the scatter plot. The two variables I'm taking, x variable as a preference and the y variable as a preservation. You can take any one, doesn't matter. I'm just selecting this because in my slide I'm showing that, so that's what I'm showing. Now this is actually a scatter plot. I want a linear line also. I can draw a linear line. Yes. So this way, and this scatter plot can be copy pasted now. That's not an issue at all. Okay. So the simple scatter diagram can be prepared. In fact, here only I will show you the correlation. Right? Correlation. How do we go for a correlation? Now you find out regression. See, if you forget, just go to every part and just click, right? Test, ANOVA, regression. In regression, you find out correlation. So correlation, I can show because correlation and scatter diagram are related. So preference and preservation quality, these two variables. I can find out Pearson correlation. By default, Pearson correlation is selected, right? So the what is the value of the Pearson's correlation? 0.888. So it's high degree positive correlation. And Spearman also one can work out simultaneously or only Spearman. So both can be calculated together, or only Spearman one can work out also. Spearman
correlation. Sir. Yes. Sir, may I?
Yes, please.
Sir, correlation value can be -1 or +1. Yes, yeah.
It is
probability value.
correlation value may lies between minus 1 and plus 1.
Plus 1, yeah.
But probability value is different. Probability value is always positive. So down below, okay. It will be the E value.
So here we have to see that whether it is coming in minus 1 or plus 1 values, like as it is showing in 0.898, right?
This is positive, high degree, positive.
Yeah, yeah. In that way we have to interpret, right?
Yes. I'm coming.
Thank you, sir.
Coming to the interpretation part, right? Just I'm showing you how to get this, right?
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So, if you want to check whether it is positively correlated, suppose our hypothesis is positively correlated. So, in the hypothesis part, only you have to check positively correlated. Yes or no. Negatively correlated, yes or no. That also. But your correlation value will never change. Your correlation value, the p-value is changing. P is probability value. I'm coming to this point when you go for an hypothesis. I hope you people are now comfortable with the Jamovi by this time. You may practice it afterwards, but at least it seems it seems that this is very easy, right? This software is very easy.
Yeah. Sir, may I?
Yes.
Sir, I found means no difference in SPSS and in this Jamovi. Can you tell me a little bit, means almost all the cran branch values and correlation, all the things are showing by SPSS software also.
Exactly.
So is there any difference is there in using both the softwares?
There is no big difference. Only thing is there are two windows simultaneously you can right? Because in SPSS and this is free software.
Okay,
those,
sir.
Those people who are comfortable with R also. I'm coming to that point. R
software. Over R here, R software is also showing in that only. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Here only R also possible. So that's an advantage of this particular technology. Nowadays everything is free. You can use it now. So correlation analysis. Just now I said about correlation. So few things I've added: positive correlation, negative correlation. But we will not stop at correlation only. We will have to test for significance of correlation. So there is something called as correlation test, right? That p-value concept I'll be introducing, but correlation one can go for, right? Similarly, this significance, this we will discuss regression analysis also. What is the difference between correlation and regression analysis? In correlation analysis, we just know that whether there is a positive correlation, that is whether they move in the same direction or opposite direction. Negative means opposite direction. But we are not sure whether one variable depending on the other variable, right? So in regression analysis, we further go ahead, right? And check whether one variable depends on the other variable. So Y depends on X, X depends on Y. So one variable is a dependent variable and other variable is an independent variable. That is what generally is checked here in this. So there are different types of regression models, linear regression, logarithmic regression. These both are non-linear, curvilinear regressions, right? So generally we use linear regression in our study, but your data may not follow linear every time. So you may have to go for logarithmic and other regressions also. Okay. So, but we have to go for regression test also. So both correlation regression test will be learning in the analysis. Okay, now we are going to a very important aspect called as, so the descriptive analysis, how to find scatter diagram, correlation table, right? Regression also table can be prepared, but regression I'm dealing later on, so I have not explained. Mean, median, mode, frequency, right? Simple histogram, right? All those things can be found out using this particular one. Now let me go to the very important section. Okay. So let me go to the very important section called as hypothesis testing. This hypothesis testing is actually considered as inferential analysis. We generally go for test, right? So now please focus. Half an hour is there. I'll try to give you as much in the half an hour now. Let us go to the concept of hypothesis first of all. There are issues with the people regarding hypothesis testing. People always feel, right, hypothesis testing is required or not. Yes, hypothesis testing is required because what is actually, what we do in a testing, we propose a question, right? Or we propose a solution to our problem, right? Which we call it as a research question. We propose a solution. And whether that solution is really acceptable or not, whether it is, it can be accepted or not, that we are going to check. So most of the time, hypothesis testing is essential. Not only this, the second thing is, for hypothesis testing, what we need is, we see, generally we collect a sample, and from sample to population, we are taking the results. So whatever we, suppose 300 samples data we have taken, on the basis of this 300 sample, we are going to generalize for say 1 lakh people, right? So 1 lakh generalization we are doing on the basis of 300. So from sample to population, when you want to take, right, hypothesis testing is required. Okay. So what is hypothesis actually? It is a statement to be tested for its validity. It is a testable statement. So testable is, so any assumptions will not do. People always say that it is assumption. Any assumption will not do. A testable assumption, right? Why assumption? Because we don't know the truth of that particular statement. It can be a proposed solution or anticipated outcome for our research questions, right? And now you will remember that when we write hypothesis, we generally express hypothesis as a relationship or a difference. So it doesn't matter what hypothesis you are proposing, you have to read it carefully and understand whether that hypothesis is a relationship type or whether it is a difference type. People ask a lot of questions regarding this, how to frame hypothesis. It may be, it can be a very simple way of framing. Just write a solution and then we have to write down that hypothesis in the testable form. We call it as a statistical way of writing null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. Now, what is null hypothesis and what is alternative hypothesis? I'm going to talk in a minute now. Right, but when we frame null and alternative hypothesis, that time we have to be very careful while framing the statement. So there we have to use either the relationship concept or difference concept. Or every hypothesis can be converted into relationship and difference concept. Okay, so and then accordingly test can be selected. So in general, hypothesis is what? It can be a statement expressing a relationship, or it can be a statement expressing difference between the significant difference, etc., etc. It is actually a logically conjectured. Conjecture is something whose truth is not known, right? So it's called as conjecture. Actually, this is a scientific word. In mathematics, we call it as a conjecture. The truth is not known. It's an open problem. Anybody can solve, or either one can prove it or one can disprove it. So it is like that. So which is a conjecture, logically conjectured, a relationship or a difference, and it is a testable statement. This you remember. There are types of hypothesis, directional and non-directional. Directional means one-sided, say women are more motivated, less stress, greater stress, less income, having less income, having more income, positively correlated, negatively correlated. When we make such type of statements in the hypothesis, those are called as directional hypothesis or a propositions. Whereas when we say both side it is open, it is different or equal. Both are equal or both are not equal, right? When we say both are not equal, when we say not equal, it can be smaller or it can be greater. Both way possibilities are there. For example, there is a significant relationship. Now this relationship can be a positive relationship or can be negative. So we are open for both. And when you are open for both, it is always called as non-directional. There is no particular direction. There is a significant difference. There is no significant difference between the productivity of Indian and Chinese employees. These are some examples of directional hypothesis, non-directional hypothesis. We generally write hypothesis in the null and alternative form. Remember that this is just a writing form, but your hypothesis is actually single hypothesis. But for testing purpose, we write that hypothesis in two forms. And those forms are called as null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. Now, what is this? Let's try to understand this. Suppose you have an hypothesis statement. You have made an hypothesis. Okay. Women are more motivated than men. The first one, let's take a case. Women are more motivated than men. And you are very sure about this, right? That is, according to researcher, this is the correct statement. You have to accept or reject, that is the latter part. But according to you, your proposed solution is what? Women are more motivated than men. Then that part will come here. Please remember. So your hypothesis is always an alternative hypothesis. Please remember this. So your actual solution or actual proposition, which as a researcher you feel correct, that will come as an alternative hypothesis. Then opposite of that will be null hypothesis. So in the simple language, null hypothesis is an opposite hypothesis of alternative hypothesis or your hypothesis. So suppose you are having four hypotheses, then there will be four null hypotheses. Your hypothesis will be placed in alternative, and then opposite hypothesis will be framed as null hypothesis. Remember this. This is for testing purpose. And while testing, in the hypothesis testing, only opposite hypothesis, that is null hypothesis, is tested. Your original solution is never tested. So in the hypothesis testing, you are going to test the opposite statement. Suppose your hypothesis is negative hypothesis. Let's try to understand. Instead of saying this, I say that less motivated. Just a negative statement. Less. Right? Less I have. So the opposite will be more. Right? More or equal. So it is not necessary that every time null hypothesis is a negative hypothesis. This is a confusion. Right? Simple meaning, if alternative hypothesis is positive, null will be negative. If alternative hypothesis is negative, null will be positive. The only problem, you know, people are facing, that we are using word no, right? When we are using the word no, everybody thinks that it is negative. But please read the statement carefully, right? There is no significant relationship. No relationship means no relation. But if I say no significant difference, right? No difference, it means it is equal, right? Two things are equal, which seems to be a positive statement also. Okay? So that no does not mean negative. If my statement is original hypothesis is negative, then null will be positive. Original hypothesis is positive, null will be negative. Am I clear about hypothesis, null and alternative? Please let me know. Please type.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Don't get confused with the thing that null is negative. Always. Null is opposite. Just keep this in mind. Null is opposite. Your hypothesis is always alternative. Opposite of that will be null. Now, what are we doing in the hypothesis testing? We are testing null. Then you will wonder why we are testing null. Our hypothesis is alternative. Why? It is actually a testing procedure which is applied in a scientific way. This is called as proof by contradiction in mathematical language. Proof by contradiction. What do you mean by proof by contradiction? What you do is, in the scientific way, in science, we actually start opposite. Right? We say, suppose I want to prove that Earth is round. I'm just taking a general statement. It is actually having geodesic associate. But if it is round, right, I just want to show that Earth is round. So what I do is, I will start saying that, suppose Earth is not round, what will happen? Suppose it is a square shape or any other shape, solid shape and all these things. What will happen? Then I will find out some information, collect some data, and I will try to prove that Earth is not round is not correct. That is, I will try to reject my null hypothesis. Then the alternative hypothesis is automatically accepted or retained. That is an idea. So we start opposite and we try to reject it. But it is not necessary that every time null will be rejected. This is again a confusion. People always say that whatever you feel, you always put an alternative hypothesis, and you think that your hypothesis, alternative hypothesis, should be accepted and null should be rejected. But please remember that you are a researcher. You cannot be right every time, and it is not your view. You think it is correct, but you need not be correct, because the respondents are there. We are going to collect. If you know everything, why to do research, right? Why to propose an hypothesis? You always say that I am right every time, but it is not. You actually find out the facts, and on the basis of the facts you decide. It may happen that null is rejected, or null may be accepted also. So whatever final results will come, you have to say that it is accepted or rejected. Don't worry whether it is accepted, because I know many of the time you face this issue. In fact, in Viva, people ask this question: how, what happened to your, why you are not able to reject your null hypothesis? What happened? Why you are keeping or maintaining or retaining null hypothesis? Is there any wrong with your study? Don't worry. If your study is conducted properly, research is done properly, you need not bother. Because remember that you cannot be right every time, right? So you are testing your thinking, and you may be right or you may be wrong. And that way, if you know everything, why to do research? In fact, if you are not able to reject null hypothesis, if null is true, you should think that, yes, I found something new which I never knew, right? Which I don't know, I found something new, right? That way it is. It can be a good research also, right? What we generally propose, we propose our hypothesis based on the earlier studies. But those studies are conducted at different place, different time, different scenario. So you may get a different things. The things have changed, and now you may get something different. Okay, so don't worry about the exact what will happen to your, whether it is null is accepted or rejected. Let me just take you some examples of hypothesis quickly. I think I'll be getting very less time now for testing, but anyway, at least few tests I will explain. Okay, so this is a particular file where okay, so hypothesis one, null hypothesis: respondents are not having high financial self-efficacy. Respondents are having high financial self-efficacy. I've written something like test here in the bracket. I'll come to that point quickly. And the second hypothesis is respondents are having, this is H1, okay, H1. I will make the corrections. Respondents are having, respondents' attitude towards money is not high, it is very high. Like that, some hypotheses are there, and in the bracket, some tests are written in the bracket. This is that file actually. This is that file. And some tests are written. Now this test we have to decide looking at the hypothesis only. As I said, there are correlation type or regression correlation type hypothesis, or maybe relationship type or difference type hypothesis. Okay, now I've spoken a lot about this. So while formulation, we have to write down H0 for null hypothesis, alternative hypothesis. They are mutually exclusive, so either one of them is true, both cannot be true simultaneously. Now the big question: can we prove hypothesis? Please remember that we cannot prove null hypothesis. We can just fail to reject it, or we can retain it. And so we are going to use word retain rather than accept. Okay. So in good statistical language, we write fail to reject, or we write retain for keeping, not acceptance. So that is possible. And there are two types of error: type 1 and type 2 error. What is type 1 error? Type 1 error is what? Rejecting null hypothesis when it is true. And type 2 is failing to reject null hypothesis when it is false. In the simple, in a simple Hindi language, I will say, sach ko jhoot manna is type 1 and jhoot ko sach manna is type 2. Sach ko jhoot manna is type 1 and jhoot ko sach manna is type 2. In the simple language. There are two-sided hypothesis and one-sided, right? Depending upon whether it's, you know, it is two-tailed and one-tailed. I was talking about directional, non-directional. Directionals are left-hand side or right-hand side directional. And direction is decided by your hypothesis, your original hypothesis. It can be two-tailed. Two-tailed means two-sided, right? Like this. In the diagrammatic language, if there are two sides, two-sided, right? Like this. Not equal to means greater than as well as less than. Both possibilities are there. So we have this type of diagram. And you must have heard about significant level. Anybody? Significant level, have you heard about? 5% and 5% and 10% significant level, 1% significant level. Yes? Have you heard about significant level?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. What is significant level? Anybody? Quickly. You may type or you may unmute yourself and say 0.05, not 0.005. 5% is 0.0. This is significant level. But what does it mean actually?
May I, sir?
Yes, please.
So 0.01 level says that your hypothesis is whether it is accepted. So it has significant level, like 99% it is significant. Whereas we go for 0.05 level, it means 95% it is significant.
Okay. Yeah. So please don't get confused with. Let us apply a simple language.
Yes, sir. May I have?
Okay. Please quickly.
Significant level is like alpha. It's a alpha, like the measure of strength of evidence. Mm-hmm. And before we reject our null hypothesis, we'll like concluding it about with a percentage of 0.05.
Yeah, okay. Let us not get confused with this. I like to be. Yeah, please wait. Now, let me speak now. Okay, so 5% significant level means margin of error. Just remember, significant level is margin of error. How much margin of error is possible in our testing? So we are going for a test. We are checking whether null is accepted, rejected or not. So in this process, how much margin of error is possible? Now, why error is possible? Because the data collected will be from respondent. And this data collected may not be 100% correct because respondents may not give a correct answers. So for that, there is a chance of error. But this chance of error is 5%. And so 95% we are confident. So 95 and 99, these are not significant levels. 95 and 99% are confidence level. And 5% and 1% are significant level. So 95% we are confident and 5% there is a chance of error. Don't get mixed up with this thing. When I say 5% significant level, so in my testing, 5% chance of mistakes or error is possible, but I am 99% sure that my testing results are, whatever I am testing is correct. Either it is rejected, accepted, whatever it is. Whatever I am doing, I am 95% correct. Okay, when 5% error chance. Whereas, when I am saying I am 1%, I am keeping 1% significant level, right? So, I am 99% confident and 1% chance of error. So, always 1% significant level is better than 5% because in 1% we are 99% confident. So 99% is a confidence level and 1% is a significant level. Significant level is a margin of error. Is this clear to all of you? Let me give an example before we proceed further. 19 bis, you must have heard this terminology, 19 bis chalega, right? 19 bis chalega. Now what is 19 bis chalega means? If there is a difference of 1, difference of 19 bis is 1, chalta hai, means manageable, chalega, right? But 18 bis nahi chalega, little difference. That little bit is nothing but the margin of error. That is what I'm saying. So, ek ka difference chalega. But remember that 1 is what? 5% of 20. Right? 199 chal sakta hai. But 195 bhi chal sakta hai. But 194 will not do. 19 bis chalega. Why we are using? Unknowingly we are using this terminology. But difference is 1, that 1 is 5% of 20. Right? That is the reason 19 bis chalega. Okay, so 5% significant is possible. Right? So this keep in mind. So in the hypothesis testing, when you frame a statement, don't forget the word significant. Right? Because significant is very important. Real difference. Significant difference means real difference that you have to remember. Okay. So this significant 5%, suppose it is two-tailed hypothesis, then 5% will be divided on both the sides. If it is one-tailed, that is alpha by 2. Alpha is called a significant level. 2.5 on the left-hand side, 2.5 on the right-hand side. Whereas if you go for one-sided, that is one-tailed, left-hand side tail, so the whole 5% will be taken on the left-hand side, or 1% will be taken on the left-hand side. If it is right-tailed, right-tailed hypothesis, one-sided hypothesis, right, directional hypothesis, then everything 5% margin will be taken. Okay. Now, what are the steps? Now, we are too late. First steps of the hypothesis testing are, you have to take null hypothesis. First of all, write null and alternative hypothesis. Decide a level of significance, test of normality, choose a proper statistical test. Then compute a test value and p-value. P-value is very, very important. P-value means probability value. If p-value is less than the chosen significant level, for example, suppose p-value is 0.02, which is less than 0.05, significant level is 5% or 1%, then we reject null hypothesis. The rejection rule is very simple. P-value should be less than the chosen significant level. Right? So there are different types of tests. How do we test normality? In the software, there are different ways of testing normality. In this software, I have given you so many, but in the software, we are going to use one, Shapiro-Wilk, right? Test of normality, that we go for it. Now, there are 2 minutes left out. I just want opinion of the organizers. Can I take 5 to 10 minutes extra?
Sure. I'm sure even the
participants, please.
Participants will definitely say yes. See, sir, yes, sir is coming because we all are gaining. Yes, sir. Okay. Everybody is saying yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
I'll try to finish it in 10 minutes. Okay.
Sure, sir.
We are actually approaching the very important aspect.
Please, sir. Go ahead, sir. Please.
So the first step is normality test. So whenever we start any type of testing, we have to check normality. Step number one, normality of a data. I have shown you at one place, right? But that is the first thing. Then if data is normal, and then you have to look at the type of a data. If it is single variable data, it is called as one sample test, right? One sample test. If it is two data, it will be two sample tests. If it is three data, three samples you have to use. So for one sample, and if the sample or a data is normal, please remember, I'm on the left-hand side, normal, then we are going to use parametric test. If it is not normal, then we will go towards the non-parametric test. Actually, the result of parametric test, the conclusion of parametric test, and non-parametric test will be same, right? Doesn't matter what you apply, but technically if you apply this test, you have to apply a proper test. Most of the time people use t-test, but if the data is not normal, you know, earlier days normality test was not done, but now you have to do properly. Everything has to be proper, statistically correct. So go for a normality test. Hardly matter of one click. So you have to go for it. And then non-parametric test, if it is applicable, required, you have to apply. Right, t-test is applicable for parametric data, single variable, one sample. I've written on the top one sample. And for non-parametric data or not normal data, we are going to use Wilcoxon rank test. If you don't remember names also, don't worry. In the software itself, it is inbuilt, right? So, and for last sample and for percentage, we apply z-test. But here, I'm not going to show any z-test because actually when the unknown variance is there, when standard deviation is not known, t-test is used. So instead of t, we are going to use, instead of z, we are going to use t-test every time. So Wilcoxon and this. So let me take you to the one testing procedure. I don't know kitna hoga 10 minute mein, but I'll try to show you some testing. One sample test. Now there is one hypothesis. If you remember, I was showing you hypothesis 5. This is related to this hypothesis. Respondents are not having high financial self-efficacy. Now this data is collected through a questionnaire and the variable is formulated. So I'm taking that data directly, right, from the file called a Jamovi file, Financial Literacy Survey, this file, and I'm going to test it. So let me go for this and I'll explain why it is one tail before that, why it is one tail hypothesis. This is that same file which I'm having. Here, there are four variables, financial self-efficacy, attitude towards money, risk-taking ability, and financial aspiration. What are these variables? How did I get this variable? I'll take 1 minute to explain this. If you go back to the questionnaire, right? Questionnaire, okay. So, you know, these are the variables here. Actually, in this study, my objective was to study the financial attitude of respondents. So for that, I've created this questionnaire part, right, where there are four internal variables from which I am going to check the financial attitude of the respondents. So the first variable is financial self-efficacy. There are six statements. Now the data which is obtained from six statements, I am going to club together. I have clubbed together, I have taken the arithmetic mean of that data. So six statements, somebody must have selected strongly agree, somebody must have selected disagree, neutral, right? And I have given a codings 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And this coded data ka average is taken, right? Average is taken. Let me just quickly go there. This data file preparation is again because of the time constraint, I'm unable to explain this, but see now this 2A, 2A1, 2A2, 2A3, 2A4, these 5-6 statements together are related to my first variable. So what I can do is, I can just prepare a new variable, combined variable, by inserting a column here. I will add this. Average I will take, average. What happened? Average. Now see 3.666, this is an average. And then I will drag this, so that it can be calculated for all respondents. Doesn't matter how many respondents I'm having, I'll just drag this. So now my value for my variable is generated. Now what is my variable? Financial self-efficacy. I'll write the title financial self-efficacy here, right? And I can make this smaller also, right? What I can do is, I can reduce my value. Sorry. Yeah. So if I do like this, the decimals are reduced. So this way I have prepared my variable, first variable, and the next 7-8 statements, second variable, third variable, and fourth variable. This way, this particular financial self-efficacy variable is prepared, right? Financial self-efficacy. If you look at the data, you will come to know that it is a single column variable. Now, I am going for my objective. What is my objective? Financial self-efficacy is very low or very high. So I am going to consider a single variable, single data. And that is the reason I am going to apply one sample test, one sample test. So in one sample test, I have two options, this two options. Now, how do I come to know where are the options? Even if you forget, don't worry about this thing. Let's go to this thing. If I go to the t-test, I have one sample t-test option, one sample t-test. Here, one sample. Click on this. Click on this one sample t-test. One sample t-test. Now it will show something. These are the earlier tables. If I don't save, this will automatically go. I can keep it also. In the same file, I can keep on working also. Actually, if I keep on multiple files, I'm keeping open. That's the reason why it is not slow. Okay. So now one sample details. Now here you will see two left-hand side main. The test part, you will find out two tests. The second one is non-parametric Wilcoxon rank test, right? Sign test it is also called, and student t-test. T-test is a student t-test, right? So this is automatic. So what is my variable? Financial self-efficacy. So this is a single variable. I'm not going to compare this variable with anything. Only one variable. So this variable I'm taking to the right-hand side in the window. Normality test I will go for. I will check whether the data is normal. Now here, how do we know that data is normal? I told you the value should be greater than 0.05. Or here, if you read carefully, a low p-value suggests a violation of assumption of normality. Matlab, the value is low, then the data is not normal. Low means what? Less than significant level. So our significant level is 5%. So if it is less than 5%, then we need not, I mean, the data is not normal. So here, what is the answer? 0.054. When it is 0.054, it means that my data is what? Normal, right? Why? Because it is greater than 0.05. So data is normal. So for normal, I will select the first one. If this is less than 5%, then I will select the Wilcoxon rank. Doesn't matter. Okay. And then, so normality test will decide. And then you have to go for descriptive this thing. And here the results are ready. Here you will see student t-test. Suppose by mistake, somebody has selected this one, right? Yesko untick kar diya. Then what will happen? Then only that Wilcoxon W will come. Otherwise, your results are very, very similar. You may go for both of them also if you are confused with. But don't do that because you should be technically, statistically correct. So for statistical correct way, you have to go for this. So normality test is very important. Then student t-test here, Wilcoxon rank test, etc., etc. You can go for it. So obviously, you can go for these results. This is the result. First of all, normality and this thing. Now, looking at these results, how do we decide whether our null is rejected or accepted, right? Or retained. Null is rejected. What was the rule of hypothesis testing, right? What was the rule I said? Rule is very simple. If p-value is less than the chosen significant level, then null hypothesis is rejected, right? Just keep this rule in mind. So in this particular case, what is my p-value? P-value here. This is the original one sample test. Normality test is used for deciding the test. Then one sample test. What is p-value? Less than 0.005. So obviously less than 0.05 or 0.01. This is smaller than that. So when it is smaller, what does it indicate? I am going to reject my null hypothesis. I am going to reject my null hypothesis. So what I am rejecting? I am rejecting my null hypothesis. when I'm rejecting my null hypothesis, what is rejected? Respondents are not having high financial self-efficacy is rejected. So respondents are, final conclusion is what? Respondents are having financial, high financial self-efficacy. That can be concluded. Okay. Yeah, so that can be concluded. Now, if I go to, now every explanation is given here. Okay, don't worry. I am writing everything on slide. That's what my material is also very important. One sample, how to go for it. Suppose you forget, the result is also here, mentioned here, everything. Right? So it will help you a lot. Now, two sample tests. Now, difference. Right? Difference. Suppose there are two groups. Now, I am taking second variable called as risk-taking ability, which is again generated in the same variable in the questionnaire. In the questionnaire, if you see, risk-taking ability is here. Right, risk-taking ability, which is a combination of seven statements, which is generated from seven statements. Now, if this variable is taken into the consideration, and I am just finding out whether there is any difference in the risk-taking ability of male and female candidates or not, male and female candidates. Okay, so the variable is what? Risk-taking ability and this thing. Now, male and female are two groups. Male and female are two groups, and they are independent. So, I am going to apply independent sample. What test I'm going to apply? Independent sample t-test. So whenever there is a, I can apply t-test, right? 99% cases me I can apply t-test, but the data can be paired or it can be unpaired. So for paired data, we are going to apply paired t-test, and for independent data, we are going to apply independent t-test. Just bear with me for 5 more minutes. Then we will stop. Okay, so let me test this, right? So I am having my data here of risk-taking ability of male and female respondents, male and female respondents. So now, instead of going for one sample test, I will go to test t-test again, paired t-test, sorry, independent t-test. Why independent? Because male and female are independent groups, right? So when male and female are independent groups, I have to apply independent t-test. Now here automatically Mann-Whitney's U-test non-parametric test is available here, right? Student test is also available here. So you know, this software is very interesting. It will help you to decide a test answer. On my slide it is there, right? You will see here Wilcoxon test, pair test, and Mann-Whitney's U-test also. Mann-Whitney U-test for independent. So this Mann-Whitney's U-test is available here. So exactly, you know, this is Mann-Whitney's U-test available because we are going for an independent. So now what is my grouping variables? How I am grouping? So actual variable is what? Risk-taking ability, which I'll transfer here, and my grouping variable gender I'm putting here. So gender-wise distribution will be there, and then I'm selecting. Before proceeding, we have to go for normality test. Check the normality of our data. If normal, then only I will select student. If not normal, I will go for Mann-Whitney's U-test. Check normality. Let's see what is normal. Now, what is the value of normality here? P-value 0.339. Can anybody will tell me whether the data, write in a chat box, whether the data is normal or not? Remember the value, 0.339. How do you decide? Low value is a violation. So whether this is low, low means lower than 0.05. Whether this data is normal or not, please type in a chat box. Normal, N type karo, type N in the chat box. Yes. If this is greater than 5%, this is normal, simple rule. So you have understood whether it is normal or not. Yes, this is normal. Now normal hai to t-test, student t-test. If it is not normal, then I'll go Mann-Whitney's U-test. Otherwise, there is no big difference. Okay. Then generally we go for descriptive, that is mean, median, mode, mean and standard deviation for this test. So we go for this. And there is one more thing called as equality of variance, Levin test. Right? This test has to be go for. So one has to go for a Levin test. Now Levin test is what? The data which we are having, independent data, can have equal variance or unequal variance. If it is equal variance, we go for student test. If it is unequal variance, there is one more test called as Bell's test. Now, how do you decide whether it is equal or unequal? a violation of assumption of equal variance, low p value. So this is again high, this is 14.5%. So this data is equal variance, so I'm keeping this. If this is very small, then I will go for variance, right? Normally distributed, mein there are two parts, okay? If the data is not normally distributed, then I will be going for randomness. This way, one by one, you can go for hypothesis and then copy paste the results. And the important thing is one has to understand the theory behind this, when to apply. Parametric, non-parametric is normally distributed or not. Two different skill is t-test for more than two groups, that is pair t-test is what pair data, and for more than two groups, right, that is three and four groups. Suppose there are four types of people, say from different community, then I will have to apply ANOVA for parametric, that is normally distributed data, and Kruskal Wallis for not normally distributed. One-way ANOVA, this is generally used. Two-way ANOVA can be possible. All things are possible with this software, don't worry. I'm adding all these things because of the time constraint. Correlation already I have told you. Regression test, again, p-value we have to look at. Correlation and regression test. If p-value is, will decide whether hypothesis is accepted or rejected. My slides are, you know, more than sufficient to understand the further part. I think in the last day, chi-square test of independence, also I told you, chi-square test, in the frequency part, you have to go for a chi-square test. Say, for example, not this, sorry. Yeah, let me just show you chi-square test, then we will stop. Right, so chi-square test, where do we find chi-square test? In frequencies, independent sample, this thing. The relationship between gender and highest educational level, for example. I want to find out category. These are categorical variables. Chi-square test is applicable for categorical variables. Then you'll find out chi-square value here. Right, if this, again, the rule is simple. If this is less than 5%, then we reject the null hypothesis. What is null hypothesis? These variables are independent is null hypothesis. They are not related is null hypothesis, and dependent is null. Okay, I'm sorry I've taken a lot of time. Actually, I wanted to do many things. As organizers are aware that generally I take a big lot of time for explaining, but this was a first day, first basic thing. So this thing, and I'm going to share all this material on my website. This link of the website I'll share with the organizers. All my files which I'm using, right, everything is available on the in my drive, right? I have prepared a separate folder for all of you. My PPT, my files, everything I'm going to share, right? Madam, I will
Yes, sir.
I will send you the link of my folder.
Sure, sir. Sure, sir.
It is ready.
Sure, sir.
So that you can share with the participants. So that they can use all Jamovi files, all Excel files, my PPT, everything is available in that folder.
Sure, sir.
Okay, so whatever I've used, and I've tried my level best to complete it. But anyway, sometimes we'll meet once again, some of you, that time we'll go ahead with the real hypothesis. Thank you very much for giving me opportunities. I'm done with this thing. Right? Any questions? I don't know whether you have time or not. Right?
Thank you, sir.
Otherwise,
yes.
You can post the questions. Okay. Thank you very much once again. Madam, over to you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, may I request you to please stop sharing? Yes, sir.
Stop sharing.
Sir, may I ask?
Yes, please ask. Please ask.
Sir, in our PhD analysis, can we use the software and put on all the interpretation and analysis? Yeah. This is really a wonderful and new experience I got today. I already done with SPSS software, but today's software is really helpful for my analysis part.
Absolutely. That's what we are conducting this session, madam.
Yeah, sir. Thank you so much, sir. It's really excellent, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I'm just looking, having a look at the chat box actually. I was trying to find out, are there any questions? But there are no questions, but only messages of appreciation. Everybody is writing down that this was very informative, wonderful session, excellent session, very enriching session. So all participants are conveying their thanks to you, sir.
Okay.
For a wonderful session. Yes, definitely it was a wonderful session. Where we were not expecting that even we are meeting through virtual mode, but still then hands-on experiences will be provided to us for using many statistical techniques based on our requirements of the research. Sir, it was definitely a wonderful session, and your introduction to a new software, Jamovi. We had heard about SPSS, people were using SPSS, but yes, this new software which you introduced today, I'm sure all the participants are definitely going to use it and get benefited, because some of the participants are writing down that yes, today's session, they have got a direction as how to go ahead with their research analysis. Thank you so much, sir, for such kind of enriching and informative session.
Thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
We need to have a formal vote of thanks, sir. So we have our research scholar, Rohini Tawde. May I request, Rohini is around?
Yes, miss.
Yes, Rohini.
Yes,
may
miss.
I request our research scholar, Miss Rohini Tawde, to propose the formal vote of thanks to sir. Over to you, Rohini.
Yeah, miss, I'm audible.
Yes, you are.
Am I audible, miss?
Yes, you are.
Karuna, ma'am.
Yes, Rohini, you are even audible. Good afternoon, dear.
A warm good afternoon to everyone. Yeah. Good afternoon to everyone. On behalf of the parent body of AGC, Gujarat Research Society, Principal Madam Dr. Anita Swami, entire AGC team, and all the co-participants of Capacity Building Program and pre-PhD course, which is organized by AGC team, AGC Center of Innovation under the aegis of RUSA, I, Rohini Tawde, research scholar under Dr. Anita Swami, Madam, have the proud privilege to have got the opportunity to convey our heartfelt gratitude to our learned resource person for today, Dr. Madhukar Dalvi. Madhukar Dalvi, sir, as Karuna Ma'am has introduced at the start of the session today morning, has a vast experience in the field of research. His expertise in guiding students as well as his personal achievements made today's session really interesting and enriching. In true sense, sir, we are very much thankful for this session. As sir has aptly mentioned, descriptive and inferential analysis is an important component of research. Sir started his explanation with a simple concept of measurement and scaling. And then so beautifully explained the different types of primary scales, nominal, ordinal, which is a very simplified way, sir, has explained. I hope every participant would have understood this. Then sir proceeded with the descriptive analysis, then inferential analysis, and very interestingly and very effectively, he has taught us the use of the new software, that is Jamovi software, how to carry out various statistical tools, statistical techniques like median, mode, how to get the frequency tables. Very interesting way. We liked it very much, sir, and we are thankful. When we'll actually use it, we'll understand better. And in case of inferential analysis also, sir has started with the basics, like what is hypothesis, what is hypothesis testing, what do you mean by actually the significant level. Then we can say what are non-parametric techniques, parametric test, non-parametric test, and etc. So it was a really enriching session. We are very much thankful to you, sir. And I hope all co-participants also, I'm sure that you all will agree with me that sir, you see then, a fluid way of presentation has touched that curious now in all of us, and we would now, we can move ahead with our journeys of research with this a better understanding of a descriptive and inferential analysis. So Dalvi sir, once again, on behalf of the entire team of AGC and my co-participants, would like to thank you from bottom of my heart for explaining all the concepts in detail and answering all our queries from time to time, as and when we wanted to know more. Thank you, sir. I now request coordinators of CVP and PPHD course, Dr. Karuna Sinha, madam, to kindly take over for further announcements. Over to you, Karuna, ma'am.
Thank you, Rohini. Once again, thank you so much, Dalvi sir. Once again, from the entire team of HSC, thank you so much. A heartfelt gratitude to you, sir, for accepting our invitation and being there with us today for such kind of a session. Thank you so much, sir. Warm good afternoon to one and all again. So we have come to an end to this 6 days capacity building program and pre-PhD course. I'm sure that all of us had a wonderful journey of 6 days. We had wonderful sessions, including today's. We had renowned resource persons who every session who enlighten the session with their unique expertise in that special area of research. I'm sure all of us who are here, including participants, we had definitely a wonderful journey together. But yet it is the time that who made this journey wonderful for all of us. There are people who have worked in front of you, and there are people who have worked behind the scenes also to make this journey of 6 days very enriching for us. So it is the time to express our gratitude to all of them. Now, I request my colleague, Dr. Usha Borkar, to propose the formal overall vote of thanks. Over to you, Dr. Borkar. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. So a warm good afternoon to one and all. One of the most fascinating aspects of research is its omnipresence, which is evident from the practice of gathering data, analyzing it, and generating insight, which is applicable in a staggering variety of settings, right from science to social studies, business to politics, and beyond. Improving and bettering practice through research and its multitude of applications is one of the most important motto of our parent body, Gujarat Research Society. And we at HJC are committed at ensuring the fulfillment of this motto. With this thought, HJC Center of Innovation, under the aegis of RUSA, organized a 6 days capacity building program and pre-PhD program on research methodology in social sciences. On behalf of our parent body, Gujarat Research Society, Principal Madam Dr. Anita Swami, the entire HJC team and all the participants, I deem it as my privilege to propose our heartfelt gratitude to all whose support and contribution have made this CBP and pre-PhD program a grand success. Be kind, work hard, stay humble, be honest, and never stop learning. This is how I can best describe Professor Dr. Shefali Pandya Ma'am, Head, Department of Education, University of Mumbai. In her session on research question, objectives, and hypothesis, Shefali Ma'am ensured that every participant was intellectually revitalized and participative throughout the session. Ma'am, we truly acknowledge your zeal and quest for being a lifelong learner and feel privileged to have received this opportunity to learn from you. An effective teacher is one who makes difficult concepts simple. That is what Professor Sunita Magre Madam, Department of Education, University of Mumbai, did through her session on research proposal. In a coherent manner, Magre Ma'am clarified the doubts of the participants and urged them to pay attention to minute details while preparing the research proposal. Our heartfelt gratitude to Ma'am for sparing her valuable time for us. Donald Campbell has said, all research ultimately has qualitative grounding. In an extremely lucid manner, Dr. Sybil Thomas, Associate Professor, Department of Education, University of Mumbai, introduced all of us to qualitative research methods. I'm sure all the participants must be eagerly waiting to explore the potential of qualitative research. We are thankful to Sybil Ma'am for her time with us and for introducing to us the vista of qualitative research. Dr. Ashwini Halve Karvande Madam, assistant professor, Department of Education, University of Mumbai, articulated the precise way to conduct and present review of related literature and describe the variables in a correct manner through her session on review of related literature and variables. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts, Dr. Ashwini, for sharing some pertinent tips, which I'm sure all of us are going to treasure and implement. Professor Pratnya Vakpinzan, Head, Department of Education, SNDT Women's University, helped us all to understand the process of preparing an apt research tool. In an extremely simple manner, Dr. Pratnya cautioned us about some incredibly significant pitfalls in preparing a research tool, which I'm sure all the researchers will take care of while preparing a research tool. Ma'am, we are grateful to you for taking time from your extremely busy schedule and sharing your expert insights with us. Dr. Madhukar Dalvi sir, Assistant Professor, Nagindas Khandwala College, in an extremely rational manner, explained different functionalities of Jamoi software and also helped us to understand what is descriptive and inferential data analysis. I think we are all still glued to our seats, wanting to learn more things from Dalvi sir. That's because of his fluent way of explaining the different steps that are involved in the entire process. Dalvi sir's entire session has been a wonderful and enriching learning experience for all the participants. And we are sincerely thankful to sir for his presence and for sharing his expertise. This capacity building program and pre-PhD program would not have been successful without the support and contribution from all our esteemed resource persons. Once again, a big thank you from all of us. The entire AJC team appreciates the efforts taken by the participants to attend this program. We have had research scholars, teachers, teacher educators from colleges and universities from all over the country. Dear participants, you were wonderful and extremely disciplined throughout the 6 days, which made us realize and appreciate your seriousness and eagerness to learn and enhance your research competences. We look forward to many more interactions with all of you. It is said, a true leader is the one who provides opportunities to learn and grow. That is what our principal ma'am, Dr. Anita Swami ma'am, is all about. This program has given each of us ample opportunities to learn and grow. From each member of AJC team, our heartfelt gratitude to our dear principal ma'am. At AJC, we strongly believe that coming together is a beginning, keeping together is a progress, and working together is success. And the success of this program is evident of our teamwork. Hats off to every member of AJC Center of Innovation and the entire AJC faculty for beautifully executing the allotted duties and ensuring meticulous conduct of the entire program. As we depart, I would like to request all of you to take some time to fill up the feedback form. E-certificates will be given only after checking for the fulfillment of the criteria for CBP as well as the pre-PhD program. Kindly wait for the WhatsApp message regarding the same from all of us. Thank you once again, one and all. With this, I request our coordinator, Dr. Karuna Sinha ma'am, to take over for the final announcements. Over to you, Dr. Sinha.
Thank you, Dr. Bolkar. I'm sure that all of us are feeling hungry now. We need to wind up. But before we wind up formally, just one small announcement for everybody, not only for those who are doing it as a pre-PhD course also. Stay with us in the group. Don't leave the group unless and until the certificates will not be issued, because we'll be sending you the messages regarding the e-certificates in the group itself. and give us almost between 10 to 15 days before the certificates will be sent on your registered email ID, which you have provided to us in your registration form. All right, so e-certificates will be provided to all of us. After checking your attendance as well as the feedback form also. So be there in the group. And again, I'm saying between 10 and 15 days, you will be receiving your certificates of participation. All of you are going to receive the certificate for capacity building, attending this as a capacity building program. All of us, I mean to say all of you who are there with us and those who have attended it on all the 6 days and have filled up the feedback form. So this was the announcement for them. So again, I'll say, please don't leave the WhatsApp group, stay with us. Now I request the participants who are attending or who have attended it as a part of pre-PhD course also. Others, I may request all of them to please leave, exit, do take care of yourself. All good wishes from Team HGC for your future endeavors. And we are sure that we are going to have many such programs again, where we hope to meet you again in a face-to-face mode, not virtual. We are not praying to meet again in a virtual mode. But yes, many such programs will be conducted in future. So now those who are participants who are there.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, all team.
You're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. Participants, pre-PhD course participants, please stay back for just for 5 minutes. All right. So now those who are there with us, who have attended this as a part of their pre-PhD course also. Now the time, because today we are not going to send any assignment. We already have 5 assignments have been posted. You all know those 5 assignments. Now how to submit those assignments? Please write down, as we have said, you can type those assignments. You must have. Make one assignment number 1, 2, 3, 4, a complete all assignments in one document, and then save that document as in a PDF form. All right. First page of that, all 5 assignments in one single PDF form. All right. In one single PDF file. The first page of that need to have all the information. Now, information related to what? Your name, all right, institution, name of the institution, your mobile number, your email ID, all right, and date also. Write down the date of the submission on the first page when you are going to submit it, all right? And this should be the first page of your 5 assignments. And then please, when you are writing down, write down assignment number 1, question, then your answer, assignment number 2, question, then your answer. And start writing down assignment number 1. When you finish up assignment number 1, then you start assignment number 2 from a fresh page. From a fresh page. All right. So we need to have the 5 assignments in one single PDF file. I hope that this is clear to all of you. Now, the submission date, I'm sure that all of us are busy, a little bit busy. And we, after having deliberations with the team members, we've decided that we need to have the submission by 10th of June. The last date for the submission is going to be 10th June. And we are giving you enough time for the submissions. A sincere request to all of you is please, don't put messages in the WhatsApp group asking for the extension of the submission date. That's a sincere request. All right. And yes, 10th June means 10th June. All right. And again, I will reiterate that please don't submit your assignments in a single PDF. That means one student will submit 5 assignments. No, it's going to be a little difficult in an online mode to evaluate them. All right, that's why we are asking that please submit it in one PDF file. Okay, so that's fine. Now, assignment, I have said you that what, how to write down, what is the deadline? All right, and on which email ID you need to send the assignments, email. So I and we, either any one of us from the team, will put up the email ID in the WhatsApp group. All right? Just immediately after the session, you will get the email ID in the group. All right. I think that's all from our side. One last thing is that after you submit your assignments on 10th, deadline is 10th. After that, you need to give us some time for evaluation, a week's time for evaluation. That means towards the end of the month, June end, you will get your certificates of pre-PhD course. All right, because your assignments need to be evaluated. After evaluation, then at least 1 week we all need to evaluate your assignments. And then yes, towards the end of the month, you will get your certificates related to your pre-PhD course. Before that, of course, capacity building certificates, everybody is going to be getting, but only for pre-PhD course because the assignments need to be evaluated. I hope I am clear to all of you.
Ma'am, is there any specification about how long each assignment should be?
No, my dear. We have provided you the format as far as the first, second assignments are concerned. And then whatever the question is asking, be specific, precise. All right? Mm-hmm. And there is no hard and fast rules how long the answer need to be. In research, we look for the how specific, precise, and to the point the answer is. Okay. All right? Because in research, we don't look at the length of the answers. It need to be specific to the point. I hope I'm clear. Yes. I hope I'm clear. All right. Yes. Okay. Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am, do you want to add anything what I have said?
No, Karuna ma'am. You're absolutely very, very clear.
All right.
Nothing, Karuna ma'am, nothing.
All right. So then, is there anything from the participants? Because I have a last one request. We have WhatsApp group. We are going to have this WhatsApp group, but that is only going to be for official purposes. Don't post any personal messages in the WhatsApp group. That's a sincere request. No good morning, good evening, good afternoon messages. That is specifically for official purpose. That's a sincere request to all of you. Okay? All right. So any official is there which you want to ask, you're most welcome to put up a message in the group. I hope we are clear to everybody. Usha ma'am, Archana ma'am?
Yes.
Can we get any reaction from the participants so that we are clear that everything is through and then we can end up the meeting then? All right.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Can I ask something?
Darshana, you want to ask anything? Please go
ahead.
Yes,
ma'am.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Ma'am, for in case in future, if you again arrange such kind of session, are we allowed to rejoin? I mean,
yes.
Apply it again or
yes.
Can we attend again?
Yes, Darshana. As this is going to be, we have said in the beginning that it is a part 3 PhD course. All right. And in future, within in near future, in near months, we are going to have two parts of this pre-PhD course also and as a part of the capacity building also. That is why I said, be there in the WhatsApp group, all right? And you can participate again for part 2 and part 3 of the pre-PhD course also, as well as a capacity building program also.
Okay, ma'am.
All right? Because right now, Darshana, you are going to get only the certificate of one part, these many hours, one part of pre-PhD course.
Yes, ma'am. All right.
Then we have the other two also, so you can join them and you will get the certificate also.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
The message, that's why I said be there in the group. You are there in the group, so we'll put up the messages in the group whenever we are going to have such kind of courses and programs again in coming months.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Welcome, Darshana. You're always welcome there. I think if I look at the chats, okay. Are there any grades in evaluation of assignments? Yes, grades are going to be there as per the norms. So give your best. Put your best when you're writing down the assignments. Okay? Narinder, I hope I'm clear to you. All right. So then, shall we wind up, Usha ma'am and Archana ma'am?
Ma'am, can I just speak? Mansi Gupta here.
Yes, Mansi.
Yeah, good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, just wanted to thank you all for the wonderful session. Seriously, and ma'am, I was really fortunate to see three of my teachers. Literally, like, your cameras are on and I didn't even miss to take a glance at all three. Because, ma'am, it's been long, like, we have seen each other. Thank you so much, ma'am.
You are welcome, Mansi.
Thank you, Usha, ma'am. Thank you, Archana, ma'am.
Thank you, Mansi.
Thank you, Mansi.
You're welcome. And a big thank you again to all of you, all of us. Take care of yourself.
Ma'am, may I? Atmaja here.
Yes,
yeah, ma'am.
Yes,
yeah, same like Mansi. Thank you so much, ma'am. I recollected my old days, the old journey, and all my three mentors are in front of me, guiding me throughout. It was like, you know, that when we're getting the knowledge from the resource persons, but my teachers are with me. So it was more a comfortable zone for me. So really, thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Always there, dear. Always there. And our good wishes are always there with you. Always there.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Atmaja. Thank you, Archana, ma'am. Thank you, Usha, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
So, dear participants, till the time we meet again, a goodbye from all of us. Do take care of yourself. Stay indoors and stay safe and stay healthy. All the best to all of you.
Okay,
Usha, ma'am, may I request you to please end the meeting then?
Yes, I'll do so. Okay, good day and goodbye, everybody.